Okay, thank you, Jonathan. Welcome to the Town of Deerfield Board of Selectmen meeting on March 9th, 2016 at 6:32. First item on the agenda is Adam. Wanted to introduce yourself, Adam, and talk to us about your event.
Okay, so the Deerfield Police Relief Association, Chad Risley and I are here representing the association. And we had an idea last year, and because of timing and the availability of shredding trucks, we weren't able to pull it off. So we talked to Kevin Scarborough in the fall, and he gave us the okay to use the dump, and we got Valley Green shredding, and the association's paying for them to come up for a four-hour block from 9 to 1 at the dump on the 23rd. So we thought the Saturday after tax day would be the best day so people can get rid of any of their documents that they want shredded free of charge. And since the DA's office is not doing a drug take back this year, we will take back drugs at the dump, anything that can normally go in our drop box. So one officer will be dedicated to that. So anything that's non-liquid and non-needles, no liquids, no IV or chemotherapy drugs. But other than that, we can take it. So this is basically a one-stop shopping for getting rid of the things that you don't want. And we thought it would be a good way for the association to give back to a demographic that we miss, because we do our sports teams every year for youth, and we've given generously to the seniors at Christmas for the past couple years. So this way we can give back to another group of our population.
Adam and Chad, that's wonderful. I didn't see anything in here, so do you have a flyer?
We haven't yet. I emailed Doug just to touch base, we wanted to make sure everything was on the up and up with you folks, as well as Kevin's blessing, before we publicly advertised it. And we'll go full steam ahead on FCAT, our department Facebook page, the recorder, etc. So
that's wonderful. I want you to know I really appreciate it, and I think it's a wonderful idea. And the drug take back thing is huge. I just want you to know that all the water that they do testing of water, the amount of drugs in the water systems in the United States is just horrendous. So you really are affecting, you know, the quality of water, and I really appreciate that by collecting the drugs.
Can we make it clear that testing in the water supplies in Deerfield are not showing the large quantities?
Oh, we don't test for
large quantities of drugs in them.
I'm talking about the public water systems that do tests for that show.
Yeah,
that is a huge.
Irregardless, our lobby is open 24/7 with a box. But
yes,
just this way we'll advertise it together, so you can shred your documents, and if you happen to have some prescription drugs or non-prescription drugs, we can take them too and make it as convenient as possible for our residents.
Mark's right. I didn't want to say that it's a problem.
Yeah.
But no, it's a nationwide issue, and it's just amazing how many drugs are flushed down the toilets, end up in our water supplies and in our rivers.
It's impossible to get it out once it's in there, so
yep.
It's really good that
sometimes
you're doing it.
A recent report I read said that fish in the Atlantic Ocean were tested positive for high concentrations of Viagra, birth control pills, and opiates.
Yep. Where are they having fun?
That's a screwed up chemical mix. Yes.
Yes, I do. Did, but all joking aside, thank you very much for trying to stem that and stop it from occurring.
Yeah. I mean, it really. That's what I was trying to say. It has a huge impact. So.
Absolutely, it's free. So.
Yeah.
We're happy to do it, and then we'll have as many of our new officers up there too to meet people and stuff like that as well. So.
And when you get your poster ready, we'll put it around.
Absolutely. We'll get a copy to yeah. Doug.
So you don't need us to vote on this, then, just saying it's okay and that we support it.
Yes. I mean, you know, we were fully, you know, in contact with Kevin Scarborough long ago, and your support is excellent as well. So I know you guys have been very supportive of us. So.
Yep. No, absolutely. And I appreciate you doing this extra stuff. Thank you so much.
All right.
Thank you to both of you.
Thank you.
It's nice seeing you too, Chad. I didn't mean to make it seem like Adam, but Adam does all the Facebook pages, and so it's really nice that he's doing that. I just appreciate
that. Thanks, both of you.
All right, have a good night.
Bye-bye. Public comment? John, I don't see you're on the... Why don't you tell us... Yes. I'm sorry. John, why don't you come up, because I don't see you on the agenda. Well, so you don't have to sit through the whole meeting. Why don't you come up and we'll do you right now?
And this, you want to wait a little while, that's fine.
Yeah, no, I didn't make you do that.
If you want to wait, that's fine. You can.
No, that's okay.
I guess I just don't see you on the agenda, so it's we want you under public comment then. So
pardon?
We want you under public comment, so we're not violating any
all right, well,
open meeting laws.
So new business then? Whatever?
Well,
I don't know.
We're going to just say public comment.
All right. On the it's regarding the draft document of the warrant for the town meeting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Article 10 about the... funds taken from free cash for capital projects.
Okay.
I guess for the record, I'm John Poreski, chairman of the Capital Improvement Planning Committee.
Oh, yes. Thank you, John.
The prior draft document I saw listed all the capital projects and how they were going to be funded and whether they were approved by the CIPC. And the one I saw showed that the engineering for the sewer headworks of $130,000 was going to be funded from free cash.
And that was an error. That was an error.
Okay,
on
but
that
that's
schedule.
Fine. And there was also showed one that the CIPC did not approve, a pickup truck that Kevin Scarborough requested for the sewer plant. And so I came to Doug 15 minutes ago and said, can I see the new articles? And understanding that that error had been corrected. And he said that it's going to be a handout, the listing of the capital projects. And I guess I would like to see a draft of that handout before the meeting takes place.
If I may address this, the schedule was on a previous iteration of this draft warrant. There was an error. The $130,000 for the headworks project was incorrectly listed as having come from being funded from free cash. It should have been listed as coming from sewer reserves. It did include the truck that was requested. Because as of last I knew, Mr. Scarborough actually requested that it stay on there, even with a negative recommendation from the CIPC. The schedule was removed from this draft of the warrant, however, because there were also a number of concerns about whether or not the town could afford all of the projects on that schedule, even with or without the recommendations from the CIPC. So instead of fostering more confusion, I wanted to not be putting it out there until such time as the board had an opportunity to review it.
To help you with the way this deals through is the fact that at the annual town meeting, the Finance Committee and the Capital Improvement Committee get to speak to the subject. And you'll see it well before, because it has to be a document that's printed well before we get into that thing. So there aren't any surprises, and it wasn't removed to keep it in guards. It was just because we don't know until we get through our budgetary process what monies we're going to be talking about, and the Board of Selectmen can opt to remove things if it's so
onerous. Fair enough, right.
It's, you know, we may not have, you may recommend it, but we may not have the money to fund it,
right.
And it may not get on there. And you may not, in the same token, you may not recommend something, and the department heads can come to us with a strong enough argument that we'll come back to you and talk to you, and we'll agree to disagree, or we'll have some dialogue that will allow us to say, you know, up front to everybody at the annual town meeting that this is your stance, and this is our stance, and this is what we're doing. Let the towns vote on it, because that's their choice.
Okay, I just think the town taxpayers ought to have the opportunity to see what it's going to look like
They'll be seeing.
Instead of receiving a draft handout at the meeting?
Yep.
Oh, we're going to have an informational night, which we did last year. Remember, that worked out pretty well. Sometime in that two-week period, 10-day period before the town meeting, we were going to have a joint finance committee, capital improvement committee meeting, and selectman meeting, everybody going over everything publicly on TV. So, you know, everyone was aware of the budget.
All right.
That seemed to work last year fairly well. I mean, normally, in years past, we are already done the budget by now, but, you know, we never know how much everything is going to be, and we never know how much money we have until the very end, and there's a lot going back and forth, and then we have to say how serious is the need over and over again, and it might be a lot more since we had our meetings in December and January, and so.
Okay.
Anyway, I don't want to discourage you, and we're not trying to pull a fast one, and thank you for coming in.
All right. No,
I really appreciate it.
I want to make sure it's rectified. That's all. Okay.
Yeah. No.
Thank you.
I just saw this, so I wasn't even aware that it was deleted, but it makes sense because nobody's decided on anything.
Right. That makes sense. Okay. Thank you.
Hey, thank you.
Thank you for coming, John.
Well, Doug will keep you in the loop when we go to discuss this the next time, what's going on. And then we'll set up a date. You know, we'll doodle poll everybody for a date that everybody can make.
All right.
Or most people can make, okay?
Yep, thank you.
Thank you, John. Have a nice night. Is there any other public comment? Okay. Mark, do you want to update us on SCEMS, South County, and Tilton Library?
Yes. And also, don't let me forget about the Historical Commission.
Oh, okay. Did you go to their meeting?
Yes, I did.
Oh,
and,
fantastic.
It was an interesting meeting. Basically, with the ambulance service, the budgets have come out. The town administrators are working through the details of the budget to make sure that the towns are coordinated with how they do their presentation. That's the extent of that. We had a meeting with the senior center director and as the board of oversight, and we're looking diligently to find an outreach coordinator to help with a grant that we have in place. We're looking for people of interest to submit letters or go over and talk to the senior center director of that interest, and we will have a committee subcommittee look at reviewing and following up what process we need to do it. It's just it's not a lot of hours, and it's not a lot of money at this point, but it does give people exposure, and it does get the seniors a lot of services which they need. Tilton Library, it's not anything's changed. Again, more is coming. They're, the build-out subcommittee and the needs committee is putting their final touches on things. There'll be some more public meetings. The architects have come back with changes that were asked for by the staff, and the public hearing that we had, the last public hearing that we had was the beginning of the month, and basically it was well-intended by probably in the vicinity of 30 people.
It seemed like more than that, Mark.
It was an awful small room, but
It seemed like there was quite
a
few. There
was a lot of people there and a lot of interest, a lot of comments, and the architects addressed a lot of those concerns. And at the historical committee last night, or Monday night, they would love to propose getting the statue to the town offices area from Old Deerfield for display, so more people could see it at the town seat. And they may be addressing that as things come forward. They are also interested in trying to come up with a subcommittee or a committee that would deal with the common and what its look would be, keeping in the time frame in which it became popular. In other words, get it back to the era in which the thing was built, and try to get a committee of people, or we have a couple of architectural studies of which I promised I'd see if I could find. We have one that's on our website. The other one seems to be missing in action. But they would like to see us have more dialogue. They would like to know if people are really interested in it, to please come forward.
This is the common down here?
The common in the center.
Okay.
South Deerfield Village.
Okay, you're referring to the South Deerfield.
South Deerfield, yeah. Common.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, because you were talking about the statue. And
right. Well, the statue, they're talking about that also, and how to get something back on the pedestal. But again, they're subjects in which I think are going to be in the forefront is basically the South Deerfield Common and other things that need to be done to bring it back to a more grander stage, in either, you know, plantings or things of that nature, which are very valid concerns. But again, people, if they're interested, need to come to the Board of Selectmen and create a committee or subcommittee. The historical has one component of beauty in the center of town, and there's other people who represent other components in the beauty of the center of town. So I guess I'd look to see if people would put a note in my box as to whether they're interested in participating in something that occurs that way, or if this is something that really is lackluster and doesn't require us to do any more work or consideration at this time. So those are two things they brought that I thought was interesting that came through the Board of Selectmen back to you guys. And any other questions or anything else?
No, I'm actually really excited because we could, the complete streets policy statement is on, and that's one of the things you have to check off to apply for grants.
Mm-hmm.
And then we could use CPA money to match whatever comes out of this committee for the common that we can integrate with the streetscape. I mean, it would be just really lovely to get going on the downtown here. So
yep.
I would be very excited about that. That's really good news, Mark.
Yep.
So what do we have to do to constitute a committee? We just have to say that we want a committee, right? We
make can a do motion it. To form a committee, right. Call it an ad hoc committee.
Yeah,
to
if
study.
It's ad hoc, then we don't have to.
And to give it a charge.
Yeah, right. Okay.
That's it.
Well, we have to get people to fill the roles before we start making a bunch of committees in which we have nobody sitting at the table.
I know. So what we'll do is we'll get started on this complete streets policy and then find out the criteria. Well, we can maybe have the be a subcommittee of the Historic Commission maybe or something.
Well, those if we're going to take the charge from us and we won't have a charge like that, then we can make it any time.
Okay.
But the two things that were being recommended is the fact that they're looking for input from the townspeople. If we're looking to bolster our complete streets or our
the next steps
that we need to do to get some of the areas we need cleaned up and addressed, then we can do that on our own. We just have to come up with what it is we really want them to do, and the common can be part of it or not be part of it. And again, which hurdle we're trying to get over at what given time.
Okay, well, it would be lovely if we were going to be able to do that. So,
yep.
For what it's worth, there's been a preliminary, and I was going to bring this up later, but there's been a preliminary discussion about a potential South Deerfield work B to happen on Flag Day on June 14.
Oh.
We have an estimated total of somewhere between 60 and 70 volunteers that will be coming from Yankee Candle to donate their time and their efforts on that day. A meeting with Marlene Johnson, Sue Corey, and I am terribly, terribly I apologize. I can't remember the name of the woman that I spoke with at Yankee Candle, but and I was also present there. We were talking about what could be possible. The project we're focusing on is coordinating with Sarah Woodbury, with Kevin Scarborough, with Kevin Helstowski, with Marlene, with the Board of Oversight for the Senior Center, and with folks related to Town Hall to do improvements on the grounds of all of those facilities.
Wonderful.
We were going to talk with folks from the Women's Club, South Deerfield Women's Club, to get their input related to the common and to get their advice and suggestions as to what could be done. There's going to be an effort to get donated materials from local landscaping companies or landscape supply shops and to make it a really coordinated effort to improve what things are going to look like. But with all that in mind, feeding right into this, with your permission, I'll certainly reach out to the Historical Commission and find out if there's folks that would like to offer input on particularly the common.
Absolutely. That would be phenomenal. The question, or the one of the things that the town is really focused on is Memorial Day. And I'm really hoping that if we kick this thing off, that some of it can be done in preparation for Memorial Day, because we do set up the parade and we do come down that route. We look at most of those buildings. So if there's something that we can do to give a jump start to some of it happening a little bit sooner than Flag Day, that would be fantastic. And I'm pretty sure that we can get with the fire department and make sure that all new flags or flags that are needed available to be put in place. And those people that would like to see a display of Flag Day along with the memories of Memorial Day, that we kind of move that forward as best we can. So,
okay.
I do not want to put any cold water on anybody's event.
No, not at all.
But I want to make sure that we look at how do we get the best bang for our efforts. And I'd be willing to put in the time also. So, I think it's a grand idea, and I thank you guys for coming up with it. It's phenomenal.
Yeah, no, it's very exciting. It's one of the areas that we were hoping to move on after all the committee work that was done. Board of Health comments, you know, it's a lovely, lovely night out. And what does that mean? Bugs are going to be starting to come out. And so if you're doing yard work, please, please make sure you're doing tick checks. And you know, once the mosquitoes come out, make sure at this time of night you are use bug spray or don't go outside or spend too much time outside. Just patrol your yard. Make sure all your water, all the potential spots for water, you're either dumping it on a regular basis after the rain or else you're checking on it. And then keep washing your hands. There's lots of cold and flu viruses still floating around. Transition season. So, and, you know, we have a meeting on next Monday, on the Zika virus and mitigation efforts that are going to happening across the state. So the next selectman's meeting, I'll report on that. Really not a lot more information since last selectman's meeting. You don't need to panic. There's not any Zika virus circulating up here at this point. Recreation Department news, do some announcements here. Is still taking registrations for baseball and softball, kindergarten through fifth grade. Registration forms can be printed from the website, mailed in, or dropped off at our rec department office. The department will be hosting a wine and canvas event on April 2nd at the Polish Club from 6 to 9 p.m. You can register online. It's wineandcanvas.com. And they will also offer a parents' night out on April 9th from 5:30 to 8:30 at the Deerfield Elementary School. Kids will be given dinner and then have opportunity to watch a movie, play games in the gym, or make crafts. Fee is only $10 per child or $20 per family. So if you have a lot of kids, it's a good deal. You must pre-register your children, and forms are available on website. So that's a good idea. Next item on the agenda.
Before you move on to that. In case you're like me and you don't get the news or you don't watch the news or read the newspaper as often as you should, in the past week, we've had local areas, towns have had devastated fires. We've had it in Marlborough. Vermont had two people killed in a daytime fire.
Orange.
And two young kids. The people in Marlborough were in their 40s, and the two kids that were in were young kids. So it probably would be really prudent of us to look at our fire safety in our households and understand that kids need to have a place to get out and understand what their escape routes are, and maybe renew the thought process of making sure you know how to call the fire department. The first case in Marlborough, or the latter case, they didn't call the fire department until it was fully engulfed, even though there was plenty of people that drove by and saw it. They just couldn't dial 911. It wasn't foremost in their mind when they're panicking about what's going on. So the reinforcement of what to do and how to do it and is the best way to stop this type of needless death. So in that area, I think that fire safety is something that probably, in light of what's happened, that you should try to review it with your kids, with your elderly population, and anybody else who forgets like I do.
We're coming up on time change.
I was just going to say, Mark has a very good point.
Yeah, the fire department always says change your clocks and change your batteries in your smoke detectors.
Make sure you have operating smoke detectors.
And there should be a smoke detector in every bedroom. And I think I was just speaking with Dick Kalaszewski about this. Every bedroom and every 10 feet is the new rough version of the code.
It's
every 20 feet or something along those lines. But at least in every bedroom, there needs to be a smoke detector. Yeah, absolutely.
Central, like hallways, when you have the floors go up.
Sure, absolutely.
For sure. That acts like a chimney, but...
Just make sure
you check your smoke detectors. You know, the minutes, I feel uncomfortable. I haven't had a chance to review all the minutes, Doug.
Okay.
I know we have an awful lot of minutes built up, but I want Dick to review the minutes regarding the elementary school.
Mm-hmm.
Since I haven't myself really looked at them carefully, other than to see the sections in there related to Dick, could we just have him review it and then we'll...
Certainly.
Take it up the next meeting. I apologize.
That's it. No more extensions.
I know.
I haven't read them either, so.
Oh, okay.
Right. So thank you for falling on your sword for that one.
Well, it's my fault. I should have looked them up on the, on our screens.
Well, we have them now, so.
Yes, I'll read them. Take them home and read them. Next item on the agenda is the Deerfield Elementary School roof. What do you want us to do on this agreement?
We have received what's called the project funding agreement from the MSBA. This is the formal and official agreement by which we agree to pay our share and the MSBA agrees to fund the project. We've been asked to have this signed and returned to them as soon as possible as the appropriation is complete. This allows the project to move forward.
Now, does Patty, as the procurement officer on this, did she okay this?
Patty has stated that this must be something that must be done. It has been before legal counsel,
and they have approved this version. Lisa reviewed this?
It was reviewed by her office, yes.
Okay. Mark, do you have any questions?
Yeah, well, following what Doug's evasive response to your question was, I want to know that the clerk of the works or whatever the title is that Patty has taken has given her authorization to this agreement. And if she hasn't, then
she's in charge of procurement.
She's a procurement, the person in charge of procurement. If she doesn't, I know we have to sign it. That's a true statement. There is no question. We have to appropriate it so they can spend the bills. But if she's not reviewing it for correctness in the appropriation of the money and she's passing it on to us, then I have a hard time with her being in charge of that.
I can't speak to that, only that I know that this came to us directly from the MSBA. I'm looking to see if there were carbon copies sent to other individuals. Marty Barrett and Patty Kavanaugh were both copied on this letter, and I'm certain that both of them have looked at the agreement and are very aware of its contents.
Well, as long as they agree with it, then I don't have a problem. I don't have a problem signing it. But from our point of view, they're the recipient of the dollars, and it's in their buildings and their facilities. We're just the signatory on the process. So I would like to make sure that if they have not, that basically they at least give us a statement that what they've reviewed here is appropriate.
All right, I will. I'm not sure that the project funding agreement actually even addresses dollar amounts. I think it's more the contract between the
it's
town
the same
and the MSBA.
Percentages, that's fine. That,
I'm not even sure it addresses percentages. I think it's just the...
It can't be dollar amounts because it hasn't gone out to bid. It should be...
That's correct.
It should just be a percentage.
Okay.
It's just percentages.
But the thing is...
Yes.
Okay, so one of the questions... was the insurance on this? So we're maintaining insurance through the whole project?
The insurance for the project, my understanding is that the insurance will be carried by the contractor. The requirements for the insurance have been reviewed by our representatives at MIIA, and they offered suggestions and advice. Those suggestions were taken into consideration, actually not necessarily for this contract, but for the bid documents. I've been in close contact with Jeff Yost about that from RDA, and our insurer is satisfied that the insurance requirements for contractors is being addressed, and is those requirements will protect the town from liability.
Okay, because I just want to make sure. This is district shall obtain and maintain all insurance, so we've got to make sure that that's sorted out.
What page are you on?
Well, it's 9.1.
Section 9.1?
Yeah. So as long as Maya, if we work, what normally happens is the insurance company will require whoever has a contract to submit their insurance to our insurance. Sure, they'll check it out, make sure it's enough, and then we carry the extra. I just want to make sure Maya is aware, because it, you know, what during construction is one of those gray areas. When it's done, it's ours. It's not an issue. But if a loss happens during construction, we want to make sure absolutely clear who is responsible for what.
Right.
And so we just want to make sure that Maya is 100% on board with us, okay?
And Maya, once again, has reviewed all of the insurance requirements that is being proposed for the bid documents, which will bind the contractor to certain insurance requirements, and Maya has signed off on that.
Okay. It's just worth making sure when we get into the process. Yes, Jeff?
Yeah, just a quick question. Do we have an update on plan completion percentage of where they're at now?
The 100% documents, I believe, are going to be completed this Friday.
This Friday?
Correct.
Okay, great.
I believe
they're
going to be made available at Town Hall as well as at Camden, Massachusetts. Does that sound right? It's the an office, I believe, of... No, it's not even the offices of Pinkin Company. I'm not even sure how the office is connected, but there will be... I'm sorry, it's where the contracts were drawn up.
Now, Doug, how does this impact the not related to this, but the timeline of the 100% completion? Is Dick going to have enough time to review, and are we going to have enough time to go out to bid? The timeline hasn't been affected.
I can't speak entirely to the timeline. I believe Dick will have just a very few short days to review the 100% docs before it starts to impact the timeline. And I know he's prepared.
Okay.
To do that, but I don't want to predict.
Okay. But he is aware that they're coming in on Friday?
I believe so, yes.
Okay. All right. Was there any other questions you had, Jeff? Okay.
Thank you.
So, Mark, what do you feel like doing? You want to make a motion to sign this? What do you think? You want to second it for discussion?
I'll second the motion for discussion purposes. The document we have in front of us requires a legal review and signature of a lawyer before our legal counsel, before it we sign it. The second part of it is we can authorize the chair to sign upon completion of whatever questions we have, because they're only looking for a signature of...
I think they want this back before Dave is back in town. When's Dave back in town again?
Next Friday.
Next Friday?
A week from Friday.
I think they want this to go out before then. I think one of us has to do it.
That's fine. As soon as we get the letter back from counsel, signed and dated, and we get the fact that the the fiscal agent is reviewed and agrees that the thing is complete and accurate, then we can authorize your pro temp today, so we'll authorize you to sign it.
I amend my motion.
Because we can't sign it. It looks like it's a signature by an executive officer, one person. You can have Doug do it or you can do it. I don't care. But I think that we need to have legal...
Let me see.
Chief executive officer would be the chair of the Board of Selectmen or chair pro temp. Yeah.
It doesn't matter. The questions I ask are very simple ones.
Certainly.
I want to make sure that we get something from the schools saying that they're good with this, that they've read it and understand it, and they're good with it because they're taking the responsibility for the fiscal portion of it. And the fact that we get the cover letter that's supposed to be signed in there that talks about legal, done before before we sign it.
Let's clarify my motion. My motion is to authorize signature of this, provided that Lisa signs off on it. Is that okay, then?
As long as we get something from the school saying that they reviewed and approved
which we were assuming.
Yeah, well, that's an assumption. That's an assumption I don't want to make. I want us to make sure that we get something in writing from them that they've reviewed it, being the fiscal responsible people, they've reviewed of it, and if they've given us that back, then I don't have a problem with it being signed. Whatever expedites it in the process, whether it goes...
Okay.
You sign it, or we have Doug sign it. As long as we get those two pieces of documents filled in there.
So, are you clear on the motion, Doug?
I sort of wordsmithed it to say to approve the PF project funding agreement, and to authorize Carolyn Shores Nest to sign the document on behalf of the Board of Selectmen upon written confirmation of review and approval of the contract by town's council and the school building committee.
No.
No?
No, Patty Kavanaugh.
Her by title.
She's the acting procurement officer on this, or the procurement officer on this, I guess, right? She's not acting.
Whatever her title is.
Yes.
She's taken the responsibility for the financial aspect of this.
She just needs to make sure that all the stuff is correct.
Okay.
Good.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, Doug.
Got it. Thank you. While we're talking about the school roof, the question came to me via email, and I didn't have an answer, so I'm forwarding to you. The 100% construction documents will be available, like I mentioned, on Friday. The question was, does the Board of Selectmen wish to have an opportunity to vote and approve those documents prior to them going out to bid?
I don't think we have to formally meet and vote on it, but I would like all of us at working with Dick individually to feel comfortable with them. Mark, do you feel it should be more formal than that?
No.
Okay.
As long as we're kept in the loop. I mean, in reality at this point, there's not much that the Board of Selectmen can add to the technical aspect of this.
That's correct.
I have done a very thorough inspection of the school. I went over on a Saturday, and Bob and a couple of roofers met me, and we went through the building and around the building, and we have a thorough understanding of what's going on. There are some other questions, but at this point, with 100% being out, those people that have questions can look at it and review it and determine whether or not their questions are satisfied or not. So, but they got to do it fairly quickly because it's a quick turnaround to make sure that we can get the system done, or get the roof done before we start school for next year.
That's why, Doug, what I am proposing is that we acknowledge to you that we are comfortable with it, okay, before it's...
As long as the plans meet with approval by
right.
the building commissioner.
We'll let you know that we've looked at them and feel comfortable with it, okay, individually, not meeting formally.
Okay.
So basically, we're going to check with Dick. Mark will probably really sit down with Dick and review it. I will look at anything that Dick's concerned about. And if it's really serious, then maybe I'll get my husband or somebody to look at it. But what I want to do is say, I'm okay with it. And then that's all right. Without having a formal meeting.
Without a formal vote.
Right. But if I'm not okay with it, Mark's not okay with it, then we get together and we have a meeting to discuss why we're not okay.
Okay. I would like to request then that your conclusions, individual conclusions, be transmitted to me in writing.
Oh, okay. That's
fine. That would be great.
Yeah, that's fine. I just didn't want us to be constrained with posting a 48-hour meeting and, all that kind of stuff. It's just more important we get moving on it. Okay. Next item on the agenda is complete streets. Mark, did you have any comments on that?
I haven't had a chance to do the second reading of it. Is it part of this package, and where do we...
Yes, it's at the end. It's just before the Healthy Watersheds grant request.
Healthy Watershed.
I hope it's there.
It's just at the very end, Mark.
I'm going to need to number these pages, and I apologize for not being able to
that. At the end, I've got the...
It's the end of the, after the school stuff.
Healthy Watershed.
Yeah, that, no.
This will be the next one. This is a new policy?
It is the same policy that was presented a few weeks back.
But we don't have one in place at this point in time.
We do not have one in place. Adoption of a complete streets policy is a necessary step if the town wishes to move forward to research and apply for grant money from the state in order to proceed with designs to implement some of these. By adoption of the policy, it's one of the conditions. Other conditions are completion of or attendance at the Complete Streets 101 courses, which we've had several people in town who have already done that. Kevin Scarborough has, and I believe there's one or two others. I'm scheduled to attend one of those coming up in early April, I believe, in Sturbridge. There's also a number of other courses that we'll need to attend in order to continue to become qualified for higher levels of grant eligibility. But adoption of the policy is absolutely necessary.
It's the when we did our downtown meetings and stuff. This is like one of the things you have to check off to move ahead.
Well, the only part that runs a flag up is when you start with the whereases, and you get to the very last one where you look at it and you say, "The town's transportation shall or should enable all users to reach any designation throughout all of the town's neighborhoods safely."
It's kind of generic. I mean,
it's kind of huge because every...
Well, that's what allows you to go out and get a grant. Because you're saying we don't have complete walkability, we don't have a completely safe downtown, so this allows us to go get money for sidewalks, bicycle, lanes, fancy crossings, road crossings, the I mean, some of the stuff we can do ourselves, but it's you, if you get the, you know, where you change the pavement and you have like cobbled crosswalks, or you have the raised reflective crosswalks, you know, that kind of stuff. You don't have, it's like down here by in front of Daylily. If you were to walk from Daylily across to Arts Bank, it's a huge, huge area, mm-hmm. free area. It's not really safe. So what this does is say that the should enable all users to reach any destination safely. So we can point at that and say, you know, this was pointed out when we had all our meetings. This was pointed out by the police. This is pointed out, you know, by pedestrians. And it isn't safe. And then this is why you should give us this money so we can do something, whatever we want.
So,
because you're saying should enable all users. So, or if we wanted money for, you know, someone that's in a wheelchair, that's for handicap accessible sidewalks, mm-hmm. so they can, you know, like in front of the senior center or in front of the library or something, whatever. Although the library doesn't have the curbs. But the idea is you say, we have adopted a policy that says all users should. We have situations in town that we're applying for money to fix because, in fact, people aren't completely safe.
So if we identified that we have areas in town that are unsafe and we do not correct them because we don't get the grant money, are we basically bitten to guilt in leaving ourselves wide open liable for...
Well, no.
Accident may have occurred because we've now identified this as an unsafe area.
Well,
I don't believe the town can incur liability in that way.
I mean, we're making an effort to apply for grants to fix an area that we've identified, but this policy doesn't identify that area yet. And until we actually apply for the money, there's no liability per se because we're not listing anything. No matter what you do, you're going to be you're liable, Mark. If somebody wants to take you to court, they can try to make you liable.
I'm not disputing that. I think you're 100 spot on, but I think that there's a big difference between when you say something or acknowledge it and being liable for something than not knowing and maybe being liable for it. There's a huge difference in my mind if someone comes up to me and says, this is unsafe, and we choose not to do something or address it. Our liability goes up dramatically.
I mean, well, people can walk in the door and say that right now.
Yep.
If we...
I mean, we get complaints all the time, Mark.
If we recognize that there is a culvert that collapses that causes a 2.5-foot gap in a roadway to appear... And we say, oh, that's a problem, and we don't put up barriers to correct it, and a car drives into that, I think a case could be made that the town recognized a clearly unsafe situation and therefore should be held liable for repairs to the person's car or medical injuries or what have you. But in terms of just stating that an intersection as it exists, even though it's properly been maintained, is not an ideal situation. And could be improved both in terms of functionality and safety, I think making that clear and coming to that conclusion doesn't introduce liability to the town.
Any more than
it's
we
not
already
gross
have.
Liability.
Not any more than we already have by having...
By not doing anything at all.
By not doing anything, right. I mean, if we go to apply for money for something, I mean, we're making an effort. If they turn us down, we turn us down. We can show that we're trying to do stuff. But, you know, I don't know, Mark. I understand what you're saying, but it said should enable all users to reach any destination throughout all the town's neighborhoods safely. All it's stating is that is our policy that we would like to pursue. And, I mean, this is like a... Truthfully, Doug, you crib this, right, mostly?
Actually, yes. For the most part, it's not entirely 100%, but if it's significantly drafted to mirror a policy that's already been approved by the state. And I want to say it's Framingham. There are still some things that could be revised, I think, but for the most part, it's a policy that meets the criteria of the Complete Streets program, both at the state and the federal level, and would be accepted if it were adopted.
And it's a policy, so at a policy, select board policy, we can change it.
Absolutely.
And we can edit it.
Change it at any point.
Right. We could edit it next meeting if
Correct.
We wanted to.
Correct. If there's changes that need to be made, I would prefer that you don't vote it, and we can certainly hold on it. It's just a second reading. The sooner we can adopt it, the better, and we can move forward with other projects, but I'd rather you feel comfortable with the policy instead of, you know, driving it into the garage knowing it's got dents. That was an odd analogy. Anyway.
No, it's a really good analogy when you think about it.
I mean, it can be more comprehensive, but I like the way that Doug has made it fairly short by basing it on one that's already been approved. It should be just approved, and we can make it longer, Mark, if you want, or more detailed.
No, I'm behind Complete Streets. I think that basically we should be working towards that anomaly, but the issue is that we're not a Framingham by any stretch of the imagination, and when we say words that, and I think we've all had the experience of people taking the words and redefining them so that it fits their envelope.
Well, I think that's where Doug edited out quite a few things that were related to, you know, a more urbanized area. But, you know, the ADA stuff, Americans with Disabilities Act, that has to be part of it. There are certain things that are ticked off. Doug, can you think of any other thing that was supposed to be ticked off in particular besides some accessibility
basically
stuff?
The policy was, as my understanding of it is, that the policy is meant to provide a broad, basically a compass point type direction to allow the town to understand where it wants to go in relation to its transportation systems. Whether that the policy does not need to, nor should it, directly address issues related to a specific curb height or sidewalk width or things of
right.
that nature, but should just broadly and generally drive efforts anytime we look at streets, street rebuilding, street repaving, sidewalk rebuilding, redesign of public spaces, that sort of thing. Even let's say we had a town common and we wanted to put some sidewalks in that town common, we'd want to make sure that they met certain guidelines in order to be compliant with a Complete Streets methodology of transportation. Kevin was talking to me also about the paving that will be probably happening on North Main Street this early summer. And I thought in my mind, okay, what does the Complete Streets methodology say about that? And does it come into play?
And any grants that we're trying to do would focus on walkability and sociability of our downtown. So,
absolutely. Absolutely.
Some of what money that Kevin is spending could be reimbursed if it's, you know, if we do a few of these things.
It is certainly possible.
That would support our walkability, sociability of our, mm-hmm. you know, Complete Streets meetings. That was the biggest emphasis was the walkability, sociability, and being safe downtown, that kind
sure.
of thing. And that's how you have vital downtowns.
Okay, so just I really appreciate the fact that you guys have indulged, has really delved into this and understand it, but I just, if we take five.
Sure.
And five. We take the example that you talked about, it's in the policy description. We talked about the description you talked about with North Main Street being taken. If you read D, E, and F, and you say that all new or reconstructed sidewalks must be, and I assume we're going to do sidewalks when we do North Main Street.
This spring or summer, I don't think, or I don't know if sidewalks are going to be part of it. I don't know.
Okay.
I'll have to speak.
But say they were, then basically we have to make it ADA compliance because it says it must be, not it should be. And that we got to give greater separation to vehicles and non-motored vehicles. And we have to keep the speed down to under 30 miles per hour.
Yep.
I've tried to get the speed under 30 miles an hour on the hairpin turn in front of the high school. And the state law says it can't be, because they've evaluated it engineering-wise, and they've set the speed limit on that street. So are we setting ourselves up for, one, bringing something totally compliance with ADA? And I'm all for ADA compliance, but sometimes it's cost prohibited because it says we must. The second part of it is we have to give greater separation because we're doing this construction work. And the third part is that we improve this theory where we're looking for bicyclists and people to walk improved.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not so much in the area, but when we get on the other side of the dry bridge where there is no sidewalk, we don't have to take more separation in that area.
Sure. They talk about on non-federal aid eligible roads. I think...
Where is that?
That's on F, further on when Mark was talking about the 30 mile an hour thing. That wouldn't apply to North Main Street because that is a federal eligible.
How do you determine that?
Because it's a state. State gets
North
reimbursed.
Main Street is not a state.
I think
North Main Street is not part of the state.
No.
It goes right out here.
Comes, Sugarloaf Street goes down Elm Street and goes out to.
So, but by using Chapter 90 funds, which come from the federal transportation, it becomes federal, doesn't it?
You really had to open that? I don't know.
I have no idea, but that's a good question. But I have no problem with
your Federal Highway Commission, Transportation Administration gives money to the state to pass on for Chapter 90.
I think in response to your initial question is, which I think, forgive me if I'm paraphrasing, would this require us to redesign our roads so they're fully ADA compatible, even if we don't necessarily have the money to do that? And I think, honestly, it would. It would require us to take a look carefully and see if we could implement those.
Instead of must, just reply should.
The must should be a should.
Sure.
So replace that.
It's a big difference between we should do something and I have no problem with this. And as I said, we can... we can approve this and amend it at any time.
Sure.
I'm just saying that basically we're doing a second read.
Yeah.
We haven't done any public hearings on it. We haven't done anything that said this is where we're looking. But I'd like to bounce it back to
Kevin looked at
Kevin
this.
And to John and say, hey, guys,
okay,
you know, are we boxing ourselves into something that we have to do? We're not a rich town. We would like to be compliant with everything, and we'd like to do the best we possibly can, but I don't want to have somebody coming back and says, you must if you take this on,
okay,
which means it could be a lot of money or we don't get those projects done.
So let me throw this at you and see if it sticks to the wall. Why don't I take this policy as is drafted, set up a quick and brief meeting with John, the chief, and with Kevin. Have the two of them take a look at it and offer review and suggestions. We'll sit down for 30 minutes, bat those ideas around, and let me bring back another draft to you.
All right.
I would certainly encourage either of you to be, you know, I'll let you know when that meeting happens. So
my biggest concern in this thing is that any place where we have committed to it absolutely is something we want to make sure we understand the impact of doing a statement of absolutely. So any place where it says you shall or you must, I would expect us to be able to answer the question that uncategorically we want to make sure we do this. If it's something we would like to do, then I don't mind the words that said we will make every intention to, or we should, or we might.
The reason why I think the must is in the ADA thing is because I think actually by law it's required.
You have to.
Yeah, I think you have to. It's law. Have to.
I don't think that there, if
you're rebuilding a sidewalk, I think it has to meet ADA compliance.
Yeah.
That doesn't necessarily mean that if there's no sidewalk there that you have to build one.
Right.
That's a different story.
Right.
Okay.
Just check with Kevin
check
is supposed
sure.
to know
that's,
all
again,
the
that's,
regs.
But, right, absolutely. And this is also where we might even, Kevin and I may be able to even talk with the folks at Div 2 DOT and see if they can offer some input on what the town would be required to do, particularly on any street where there is federal money being used or on the state roads that come
well,
through the center of town.
Well, definitely what federally funded or non-federally funded roads
find
are.
Find out what that
nice.
Means. Sure, certainly.
I'm pretty sure that Chapter 90 makes it federal funded, but whatever. Can you make sure you put it on for 2 weeks from now, Doug?
So I will.
So we can move on it because we are coming up to construction season, and I want to make sure that if there is opportunity to get some money, we are eligible. Healthy watersheds.
I don't have a problem with signing it and just ask for the people to do the review for those concepts and get back to us on what the outcome is next in 2 weeks. That way we've got it on the books. I don't have a problem with that. If you guys think it's time sensitive to that degree, then I don't have a problem, but I do want to make sure that we do
I don't think it's
evaluate.
I mean,
it's not so time sensitive that I can't wait a couple weeks.
I was just going to say, there isn't any grant that I'm aware of that we're applying for at the moment.
And the more eyes we have on it, the better it'll be. And I completely respect where you're coming from for that. So
let me
do some more research and review, and we'll see what we can get.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is Healthy Watershed Support Letter. Debbie Shriver is representing the Conservation District. And I'm chair of the Conservation District, Franklin Conservation District. And this is a grant that is the FERCOG and Conservation District is working on. And this is to help people do zoning. It's a toolkit. It's if anybody wants to do a watershed protection district, like a water district, or a floodplain, revise a floodplain. Since Irene, our riparian buffers have been totally trashed and are about 16 feet lower along the Deerfield River through town here. So part of the relicensing with TransCanada is we're having TransCanada redo some of our vulnerabilities with their floods, and so by adjusting their flood impact areas, that's helping us redefine our floodplain. And what this will be is a template that we could just put this information in and be able to readjust and apply to the federal government to adjust our floodplain based on the new heights of the riverbank. I know it sounds complicated, but this is a little bit of grant money that we got to do this template for all these communities up and down the Deerfield River. Well, it can be used by anybody, but in particular for our Resilient Communities group to use to adjust for this kind of adjustment of the floodplain or a water protection district, like in the case of Shelburne and Buckland that I have real problems with. Their water district has been realigned through the river, change in the river. So it's just a letter of support to go in. It doesn't cost us anything, but it looks good to have the town of Deerfield sign off on it.
I move that we sign the letter.
Second. Is there any further discussion?
I have none.
Okay. All those in favor?
a formal copy if you want to sign there. Someplace for signature.
Aye.
I believe.
Aye.
Aye.
Oh, whoops.
Oh, sorry.
I jumped the gun.
Hopefully this will happen. Doug, while we're talking about letters, can we just jump down to business not anticipated? Because there's another letter of support that we're not, you don't have, but if we were requested by the town of Montague to send a letter of an additional letter about the General Pierce Bridge.
Ah, okay.
And so I would make a motion that we, as the town of Deerfield, write another letter of support for the town of Montague in their appeal for the state to fix the General Pierce Bridge. This will be the third letter, Mark. It's not new.
Well, forgive me for not knowing what bridge we're talking about.
It's the bridge between Greenfield and Montague at Cheapside.
Okay.
Goes over to the Farron.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you knew that as a general.
That bridge is the one that has had holes like open up, cavern-like over the past year.
Every time we have a storm, the chunks fall down in the river, and there's holes to the, and you can see the water underneath. This last event was terrible.
The letter to Montague, is that for the $10,000?
No.
No.
This is just supporting.
This is to the Department of Transportation.
To work on the bridge.
Please fix the bridge because it's really dangerous for our residents, Greenfield residents, Montague residents, go over that bridge. This last rainstorm we had a couple week ago or 2 weeks ago, the bridge was completely shut down because they had big holes.
Right,
and and you just look down into the river.
Yeah, the General Pierce.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, it's unbelievable.
Okay.
We've already written a couple letters. This would be the...
That's in bad shape, that bridge, no question.
It's not even on the state list.
Yeah,
but it's scheduled for repair in like 2026 or something insane.
Well,
it's not going to last that long.
And the one concern I have is the harder you push it, the state will just close the bridge.
That would honestly, that actually can be part of the letter, because if that happens, that will dramatically affect traffic flow in Greenfields. It'll affect the ability of folks who work in Deerfield to get home to their homes in Montague.
But that's what our letter says, is dramatic impact of not having an availability of that bridge.
Well, that, I mean, this is one of the subjects in which
It's emergency access.
It's an emergency access. I mean, the big issue for me is we've identified it from not our town, but if it was in our town and stuff were falling off of it, I couldn't sit here and let people continue to drive over it if things fell down.
The state comes out and patches it. But every time there's some kind of event...
They're closing our dry bridge.
I know.
And it's not following in, but till you've got stuff going over the Connecticut River at 50, 60 feet over, and you've got...
Well, this last
that's
packet...
That's a scary thought process.
This last packet, they sent pictures of the holes that... And you can see the water underneath the bridge from the pictures. And it is pretty disgusting. So Doug, you will gin up that letter, another additional letter, and then we can sign it at our leisure.
To the Mass DOT and other applicable parties?
Yep. The same group, same legislators, everybody.
If the Board of Selectmen has already reviewed or already has a letter, my recommendation is that we have you create the same thing. And just have Carolyn sign it at her leisure.
Okay, that's fine. So we just have to send
pro tem for this meeting where it was approved, have her sign the document and send it out. It's saying the same thing we've already approved here, so we don't need to reapprove something that we've already approved before.
I saw Mike
Nelson
at a meeting, and he really said he really appreciated us if we could send another letter.
It's fine with me. I just, if we keep it consistent, then we don't have to get caught up in what it says or how it says. Just use the same format.
It's fine.
Put it out, and you can make mention of it because we are agreeing to it. Basically, this would be a third issuance of plea for help, or however you want to do it, in that light, and then give them the rest of the details which we've already approved.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is the 2016 annual town warrant.
Is there any other business that has come before the board that we didn't, that's an emergency that we haven't had time to deal with? It fits that 42 or 48 hour time.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize.
I just want to complete it out.
That's fine.
There was one matter that came before the board, but or that I thought would be on the agenda, but the person who was speaking to me about it actually requested that it not be addressed tonight because there are some outstanding issues. And I'll explain it
all right
to both of you individually afterward.
Okay.
If there's nothing else, and yeah, let's move on.
Okay.
I just didn't want to close something out and then
That's fine, Mark.
To go back to it.
No, that's fine. I just didn't want to forget the letter to Montague. I didn't want it to wait two more weeks. And it was my fault. I thought I was going to have a short meeting today, and Doug was on the phone, and I had to go home and get back.
Fair enough.
Okay. So the warrant articles.
Yeah, so you have copies, draft copies of both the annual and the special town meeting warrant.
Did you guys have copies?
There are extra copies up here and available for folks if they need it. Let me start from the beginning. It was recommended by moderator Peter James that certain articles dealing with certain subjects be put on a special town meeting warrant, particularly the articles that were time sensitive or that needed to be addressed prior to a town election. And that's why I separated certain articles onto special town meeting warrant versus leaving them on the annual. Further, some of the articles on the special town meeting warrant, which is the single page you have, deal with immediate appropriation of monies out of accounts for specific purposes that are more time sensitive. Instead of putting them on the annual town meeting warrant, where most of the appropriations are for fiscal year 17, it seemed to make sense to sort of segregate them out onto a separate piece of paper and then hopefully into a separate mindset of on the members of town meeting floor. So there's that. We haven't officially opened a warrant for a special town meeting. So that's very much just a draft. Both of these are just drafts at this point.
Okay.
How much time do we have before we open a warrant?
A warrant for a special town meeting, the time constraints are much lower. We would have to close it, I think, within 30 days of April 25th, so March 25th. But it has to be published at least 2 weeks prior to the date. Whereas town meeting, the annual warrant actually is only 1 week.
So make it clear, we're talking about having a special town meeting
immediately prior.
Prior to having our annual town meeting, so everybody would have the same, it'd still be there, but we'd just be a little bit earlier.
Correct.
And we would do this, close it out, because then we would be able to put this information into our annual town meeting for the next year's appropriation
Correct.
Of money.
Correct.
So all we're doing is cleaning up. This is housekeeping cleanup for things that got overspent, salt in that. Some money needs to be billed to the South County EMS and other things of that nature, which the moderator has the right to ask us to do.
When, Doug, our next meeting is when?
The next meeting is the 18th, which is a week from Friday. That'll be another day when David will be
so
available.
Why don't we open it on the 18th and close it on the 18th. That gives us some time to think about it.
Okay, fair enough.
And see if anybody has any feedback on that. I mean, it seems like they're straightforward articles. This is all has to do with money that from this year.
Yes. And I sincerely apologize. I didn't thoroughly review the timeline for a special town meeting warrant, and I apologize for that. I feel unprepared as a result.
That's okay.
Well, the thing is, if our next meeting sets us in the doghouse, and we can call a meeting first Friday or next Monday or Tuesday or something like that to take care of it. Or next Wednesday we can have a meeting. So
certainly.
And we'll, our game plan is, so that everybody understands it, is we will open the special town meeting warrant articles and close them the same day, so that if there's other things that people feel need to be in there, they need to get them into Doug so that basically they can make a full package.
Right.
And the reason we're doing it is not to exclude somebody from getting in there. It's the fact that we have to have the time to publish the documentations, proofread them, have them go through legal, have them do everything that needs to be done. So we're not, you know, we saw these today for the first time. What we're saying is get your things in here. If you think there's something that needs to be on a special town meeting because it's time sensitive for funding, then get it to us so that we can get it on that list and get it done. If it's not, then it will go into the regular town meeting, which...
So you're going to keep that open until the 18th?
No, this will be...
We're going to open it and close it.
This will be open and closed on the 18th if it complies with what the rules and regulations are for posting.
Right.
And, or...
One thing that...
So just, everybody just read it.
Right.
You know, so see if there's anything else.
It's still open, so if somebody from the public wanted to add an article, they could at this time.
They could submit it to us, yes.
Okay. Let me remind everyone.
It's not open.
There are two separate warrants that we're talking about.
Yes.
The special town meeting warrant, which is the one-page handout, is not open. That's simply a draft document that consists of basically articles or information that's come before through this office and to the Board of Selectmen that will probably be best addressed at a special town meeting. That's an unofficial draft. There is no warrant for that because it hasn't been opened
yet. And we're planning to open it and close it on the 18th to meet posting requirements.
Right. The two sheet.
So the special is not open.
It is not open.
That's
correct. The two-sheet document that you have that's stapled together is for the annual town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
That warrant closes today. So there is no further opportunity to add articles to the annual town meeting.
Yeah, and there's no opportunity to add articles to the special town meeting.
Not yet. Actually, you can add. You can submit a petition to add an article to the special town meeting, either through an informal request to the Board of Selectmen, and if they choose, they can add it to the warrant.
We're
going to
open
choose.
It and close it the same meeting.
Right.
But that doesn't mean that.
So you'd have to be here the 18th to.
You could submit it. And
you can submit it for consideration.
If it meets the criteria of the moderator, which means it's something that's funded this time and it's time sensitive, we will consider it and it will be put in place. If it's something that they deem, the moderator and the legal people feel that it's something that should be on an annual town meeting, then it won't go on a special because we're trying to keep them in their own formats.
Correct.
So
if a person wishes to have an article on the special town or on a town meeting, special town meeting warrant, the requirements for submitting a petition to do that, like this petition that I've got here, are that you submit it in a timely manner and that it have 100 signatures of registered voters. The requirements for an annual town meeting article are much lower, 10 signatures certified. As a matter of fact, the last article on the annual town meeting warrant is submitted by petition. By submitting an article by petition, the Board of Selectmen puts it on the warrant. There's no discussion, there's no debate. If an article is simply suggested to the board, you have the option to review it, consider it, and if you choose, put it on the warrant. It's up to you. I hope that makes sense.
Right.
Now, as far as these articles, whether it be the special or the annual, these all come from the select board and interim business manager?
90% of them are boilerplate. They're seen year after year.
I think your question is, we opened the warrant, this particular warrant, this article, for a period of time in which people have the time to come in and talk to us about them.
Okay.
And we consider them as being, you know, needed to be placed on, and it gives them enough time to go out and do the petitions if we disagree with it. So it's open for that period of time to give us that feedback. So anybody that wanted to come in from the time we opened it 2 weeks ago to the 18th it's fair game. You come in and do it. When we close it, it's so that we can make the document whole to go to print.
Right.
If somebody comes to us and say, hey, you forgot something.
It's too late.
We can say, okay, let's open it and close it for a day because this is important to town business.
Mm-hmm.
It's trying to get us to think ahead about what is the important things for town business and what is important for discussion.
Or like in 2014, we had already closed the warrant and it was at the, you know, getting printed. And, you know, people came with a petition to have us make a resolution against the pipeline. And we said, don't, you know, you don't need to have a warrant article. Just at the end of the meeting, give instructions to officers. And we, that's what we did, is pursue trying to meet with Kinder Morgan. And then we ended up not being able to meet with them. They never would agree to a date. So that's when we had, we just set an arbitrary date, August, what was it, 20th or something, in 2014, to have a town meeting to have a resolution. Because,
right,
you know, so we could...
Well, I just want, so the public understands where some of these articles are coming from. You know, Doug had mentioned boilerplate, and I understand, but there's several articles here that are very specific to certain items.
Right.
And that is because people have come in and spoken to the selectmen and said, what can we do here? And you've, and the selectmen have basically decided to put that on the warrant.
Right. Well,
is that my understanding? Yeah. I just want to make sure.
We are closing the warrant now.
Yeah.
If an article has been presented to us that is illegal,
mm-hmm.
then it will be passed over.
Yeah.
We will not allow action to be taken on something that puts us in jeopardy of a legal action.
Right.
It's the same thing. We put some, a lot of these things as placeholders,
mm-hmm.
to be able to,
right,
to have the discussion. We may just pass over them because nothing came forward for us to consider or vote on.
Mm-hmm.
But we're trying to accommodate everybody who's come to us and indicated that they would like to have their topics discussed in an annual town meeting.
Okay.
And as Carolyn said, at the very end of the day, even if you don't, then we don't submit this, you can give instructions to officers and people can...
I mean, instructions to officers are not binding, but I have to say the select board has always taken to heart people's concerns and try to address whatever people's instructions to officers are. Like I said, it's not legally binding. You don't have to do it, but I mean,
there's,
if people are sincerely concerned about something, I think we as a board have traditionally always tried to accommodate people's concerns and address whatever instructions are been done, you know, directed to us.
Mm-hmm.
There are four types of articles that can be on a town meeting warrant: an article to appropriate money, an article to establish, modify, or delete a bylaw, an article to set a penalty for violation of a bylaw, and a resolution. A resolution is non-binding. The other three are. That's the only type of legal article that exists.
Right.
Instructions to officers, as it's been used historically in the town of Deerfield, is considered a resolution.
Well,
be it resolved that the town of Deerfield directs its
depends on how
officers
they write it.
To do.
You can actually ask for your instruction that says we want you to do this and not have it we resolve. It's we want the.
It's not only not legally binding. It's not appropriate. It's inappropriate for the legislative to direct the executive to do something.
Well, anyway, we try to
sorry,
do as I know
constitutional fundamentals.
We try to
here,
respond
sorry.
To people's concerns. I mean,
sure.
I mean that's
I
why
just
we
want to make it clear
yeah. But I mean that's why
everybody else too.
I'm do this is because I feel, you know, if people are concerned about something, then you want to try to help. You want to try to fix it. You want to try to make it better. Whatever. And if people are legitimately concerned about something, you want to try to figure out a way to at least resolve some of it. I mean, you might not be able to do very much, but you know, you could do a little bit.
Yep. Thank you.
Or at least talk about it. I mean, sometimes talking about it helps a little bit too. So, whatever.
If I may ask, is there a particular article you had a specific question about?
No, I think there's going to be several articles there that are going to need to be discussed on town floor, unfortunately. I was hoping some could be discussed ahead of time, but obviously...
Oh no, we'll have an information night like we
right.
did last year.
Well, I know the general...
And go over the budget, go over warrant articles.
Right.
So anybody that has discussed, you know, so if there is discussion, we can have discussion and
I'm just going
get further
back
information.
I guess what I'm doing is I'm going back to town finances, and we all know the budget's going to be tight in that. And when I look at some of these articles, you know, we could be racking up some pretty serious money here. And I do understand that to run a town, you need to spend money. There's no question about it. But, you know, I just, we're at a point where I think to spend wisely, and there needs to be at some point limits, I think. And so we'll see how it comes out. That's all. I care about Deerfield. It's a town I've lived in for about 40 some odd years, but I also care about the people that live in Deerfield. And some of them now are struggling to stay in Deerfield because of our taxes. And it's unfortunate.
Absolutely.
You know, and I also, you know, I don't have kids in Deerfield here, so it's, so be it. But, you know, families and that stuff, as I've said before, we keep going the way we're going, and their kids aren't going to be able to afford to live in Deerfield. So that's what I'm concerned about, is the sustainability of the town of Deerfield.
Jeff, you know that is a perennial discussion. What we're doing is not sustainable, and you know that. So.
No, I know. I know we've discussed this on different occasions.
So. One of my goals on a slightly different tack, one of my goals is actually to allow the town meeting warrant to provide as broad of a discussion on any given topic as possible, and to provide as much flexibility both to the board in making any given motion and also to town meeting members in determining what actions they wish to take on that topic. To that end, I am trying to revise some of these. I will likely be trying to revise some of these, removing dollar amounts, for example, which will allow the motion to designate the dollar amount and allow us the flexibility of determining what that dollar amount is going to be, let's say up to 2 or 3 days prior to town meeting. Instead of locking us in with a town warrant that says $11,000, in which case you can't exceed that, and all you can do is reduce that, and that's the amount of money you're talking about, I want to be able to allow the flexibility to say, you know, instead of $80,000 to the reserve fund, we have extra. It makes more sense to put a little extra. Let's make it $120,000. You know, whoever is in the place to be able to make that recommendation.
Actually, I was hoping we had to, at some point, do have some discussion on that, because I think that 80 is a little low.
It's extraordinarily low.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping that we can...
What?
Two things to address that, if I may.
You? Wait a minute.
Can
you hold for just a second? I was distracted. I apologize. Would you repeat what you just said?
Oh, I said I was saying I was hoping there would be some discussion with the Finance Committee about increasing the reserve amount, because I feel like, you know, we get department heads to budget the line items so close nowadays that, you know, if something happens, there's not enough money in the reserve fund for things. If we have an unusually bad year. I mean, if we have events. I mean, we haven't had a lot of events this year, but 2011 was a very bad year.
And
there was
we
got very close.
But again, keeping it at $80,000 is the earmark for making sure that we do have good budgets. And we've done this in the past, we've taken people and told them, hey, cut your budget so that it looks good, and then we'll take money out of the finance...
The reserve fund.
Reserve fund to cover it. And that's the wrong message. Make your budget what it needs to be, and if we need to go and justify why it's off, then we're doing it on its merits, not on the fact that someone told me to cut my budget so that I could get more
Mark,
money out.
Mark, we just, that we haven't... We've been at 80 for many, many years, and we haven't, you know, given inflation and given that, you know, we're still budget crunching, we upped it. What was it? We upped it from, I can't remember what it was, to 80.
We had it at 20. We went from 20 to 30 and then 20 to 50, and then we went to 75, and then we went back to 50, and then we went to 80. We're all over the place, but the reality of it is it's supposed to be...
It's been at 80 for
strictly,
quite a while.
Yeah, for quite a while. But it's strictly for those things that are totally unforeseen.
I don't disagree, and I'm completely in line with what you're saying, absolutely. I would like to remind folks that this year we used $25,000 for the traffic loop at Deerfield Elementary. We had the potential of using $15,000 to fund the funding gap for the Deerfield Elementary School roof. Kevin is currently working on a project on Mill Village Road where the price tag will probably reach $20,000, could be as high as $30,000. And while he's hoping to get a release of Chapter 90 funds to pay for that, if that's not possible, he's going to need to find the money somewhere, so he may go to the reserve fund for that. Yep. And between those four projects, that's $70,000, or the possibility of $70,000. Yep. I know there will be an overage on the health insurance, or an underage, if you will, on the health insurance line item, the group insurance. So Barbara will need to come to the Finance Committee to request a reserve fund transfer for that. That's about a $40,000 line item. Because of a calculation error, thank you, I did that, that left her short. The appropriation was short.
So
we've used up that reserve fund.
But we right now have a special town meeting, which we can sit down and talk about any and all of those things and put the money in there to pay for it now.
Or just directly appropriate from free cash, okay. Certainly.
To cover
you're
it.
You're absolutely right.
It's the thing about right. I think 80 is a really good number because it's high enough that we can cover any single event that's catastrophic without being close to a special town meeting. But it's not so big that people just get used to, well, I'm going to go to the well and pull the money out. If we are constantly getting close and we're constantly hitting $70,000 2 years in a row or 3 years in a row, or we went over a year and then hit $70,000, I'd be right behind you. I'd be saying, hey, we don't have enough. Mm-hmm. But I'd also be looking at the department heads to say, listen, you know, we missed this, and if we need to have a fund that has Kevin take care of things that because of climate change, we've got more things happening, then we should have a fund that says because of climate change events, we should have money in this account, and it can only be used for climate change issues, and we plan for it. Okay. But we're admitting we know we have the possibility of, it's no different than snow and ice.
I know.
We created a fund knowing that we can't judge it. We have no idea. So let's put money in this little fund and say that basically when snow and ice happens, we can do what we got to do.
Structurally? Yeah, I don't see a difference. Well, no, structurally, I don't see a difference between what you're talking about and the reserve fund because the end goal is still reached. Let me ask if there is a political difference between the two.
Well, there is a structural difference because at the end of the year, if the reserve fund is not used, it rolls over to free cash.
And at the end of the year, if we don't appropriate out of free cash at a special town meeting, that also rolls over into free cash.
Well, it just to set aside for climate event change, just or climate change events. Well,
yeah,
I mean I use that should be Kevin. Kevin needs to be putting some kind of thing in his budget for replacing a culverts once in a while.
Well, that's part of the capital
yes.
things.
Capital but we only do it on emergency, so rather than regular.
If we keep it in the loop we're in right now, and it's cultural, it's not political, and it's not there's no difference. You're 100% mm-hmm. spot on. Mm-hmm. Whatever doesn't get spent out of that fund is going to go back into free cash, and anything that doesn't get spent out of the reserve fund for the finance reserve fund goes back to free cash. The thing I'm looking for is a cultural thought process that if you have something that's hitting us time and time again,
it should be in a regular budget.
We should make a budget item for it, or it
absolutely.
Should be in there to take care of it. But if we don't do that and we just go back for appropriations because we miscalculated or we did this or whatever, it kind of gets washed because we don't think about where it came out. When was the last time we did an evaluation of all the reasons that we took money out of the Finance Committee's fund over the last 5 years? Why did we do it? Is there some theme there? Is there something we did that? Well, it's a small enough dollar value at 80 that I don't really think that we need to do it. But if we hit $100,000 or $150,000 and we're bouncing up against it on a regular basis, there should be some reason why. And again, I'm not...
I was just thinking giving another $10,000.
You want to talk... a few thousand?
Yeah, like, you know, make it 90 instead of 80, just for inflation.
That's basically a 12% increase in the budget item. It's, if you want to do it, then,
right. No, that's
then yeah,
fine.
A couple few dollars.
Well, we haven't done it for years, so whatever.
My understanding also that the reserve fund is something that's generally only used after the annual town meeting and until the end of the year.
Yes.
We used it for the Deerfield traffic loop this past fall. Was it?
Because that was really a safety issue and nobody budgeted anything.
Right? And instead of having an entire special town meeting just to do that, it was determined that the most expedient course of action was to just do a reserve fund transfer.
We wanted to get it done before.
So in that case, I think you're absolutely right. That was kind of an emergency thing. It was a safety issue. And that's where coming from the reserve fund made sense.
Right. And the thing about it is, in that light, I would have said it's not a standard item that would go to the reserve fund. So we didn't hit the $80,000.
Not at all.
We were way away from it if you took that one item out of the mix.
All
Instead, we're sitting at about $40,000, $45,000.
Sure.
Well within the means of it.
Sure.
And you said, we're looking for something that gives us meat so that we don't have to do what we're doing for the ambulance service. And these other items where we missed it, we're looking for something that we could do it without having to get back into an annual town meeting mm-hmm. or a special town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that the $80,000 is a good number.
It's fine. I just wanted to discuss it.
Sorry about
Actually,
that.
Actually, no, I think, honestly, it's a really good discussion. I'd like to thank you both because it's education for me. And honestly, you brought up many points that I hadn't considered.
This is what makes it work. If you have the conversation and just go through it. So I'm sorry for derailing your thought process, Jeff. So if you can remember what you were going to ask before
I
stuffed it.
Believe it or not, I do. No, I was just going to make two quick comments on that. The public information evening or whatever you prefer to call it, as far as being able to discuss where we're heading with and give an overview of now the special town meeting and the annual town meeting, I think would be very beneficial. Hopefully people will take advantage of that time. And not only...
It seemed to work last year, don't you agree?
Pardon?
It seemed to work last year, don't you agree?
Yes, it did. I thought it was helpful, and I think a lot of people got a lot out of it. Even though it wasn't a huge crowd here, hopefully people are more aware of what's involved now. And hopefully on that evening, that it could be open, and I know it's going to drag it out a little bit, but be able to allow people to ask some specific questions.
Oh, yeah. No, that's the whole purpose.
Some of the articles and that. I think it'll clear the air, and it could be a benefit to speed the process the night of the special town meeting and the annual town meeting. And just in case, obviously, there's some people that are going to walk into the annual town meeting, special town meeting, and see these for the first time, and may not have a clear understanding the way, you know, some of these are worded of what's behind, why, the reasoning. So as Doug had mentioned, that maybe being able to allow for a little additional time for both the committees and the public to discuss a little bit.
Oh, no, absolutely.
So
did
hopefully,
you,
hopefully.
Do you
otherwise,
have...
you know, also, if we're trying to keep some of these articles to 2 minutes, 5 minutes, or whatever, I think there's going to be some people.
Oh,
that are
absolutely, absolutely. So, did you have any? Which ones did you have questions of that you think we should focus in on, or that are you aware of that people might have questions on?
Well, I think some of the South County things are here, EMS, and that people are going to ask some questions about the amending of the bylaw. As far as the sewer use fees and that, people are going to ask questions about. What I really don't want to see with the sewer issue is this town all of a sudden pitting sewer users against septic systems. And I really like to avoid that. I'm hoping that people can discuss this and maybe be able to compromise at some point try to work out a solution that's workable for the entire town.
Do you have...
I understand that people see it differently at times, but hopefully we could talk about that and do something with that. So, and the other one, Carolyn, that I was a little concerned of, and it doesn't I'm not taking any stance on this, was just the transfer of possible $10,000 to Montague for intervener. And the only reason why I ask that is, if I remember correctly, our council, because of the Deerfield lawsuit, has kind of warned us in a way not to be trying to do something else. And I'm just wondering, would that jeopardize? I know it was discussed with another member here of Deerfield becoming an intervener, and we were basically told not to do that.
Actually, that's one of the articles that's going to be reworded.
Okay.
We had set aside the $8,500 for the FERCOG to help us with intervention.
That was done before.
And then we're not actively participating with that intervention. Mm-hmm. And what is happening now, I don't know exactly how much Montague has already paid. They appropriated, they had to go to their stabilization fund to do it. But the town of Gill voted $5,000, and I think the town of Northfield is either doing $10,000 or $15,000. And so what I did is take the $8,500 that we appropriated from the FERCOG that we didn't spend from last year, mm-hmm. and then I just added the $1,500, because remember, we were going to intervene jointly with Montague,
right?
Because we were ratepayers, so we had automatic intervention status. And what was going to happen was most of the other towns like Northfield, Ashfield, Conway, the ones that didn't have a seat, automatic seat at the table, were hopefully going to contribute. And it looks like Montague went ahead alone without us because we were not allowed to intervene, because then we could get deposed, which would muddy up our set. So Montague voted to go ahead by themselves on the faith that other communities would step up. And it looks like, well, Gill has already voted $5,000, mm-hmm. and everybody else has it on their warrant for the spring. So it looks like Montague will have not be bearing the whole financial burden. And that will be, it looks like it's going to, if every more or less all the towns pass, then Montague will be paying a fair share, but won't be on the stick for
my only concern.
Because they've already spent like $26,000.
Right. My only concern is that with Deerfield having the suit going.
Oh, that's why we're going to change it.
All this time, we invested all this time in that, in all this work. And all of a sudden, if we do something like this, if are we going to jeopardize the whole thing by...
No, because we're not going to say it's for intervening. It's going to be
even
for expert advice or something. The town council in Montague has the warrant article, and I had Doug check with Gill to see what Gill had worded it, but
as long as we're
going to reword that so it doesn't say intervener, even though it's for expert counsel to look at Berkshire Gas's. What's difficult about this is they hire a lawyer, mm-hmm. and they hire expert opinion, and they go through Berkshire Gas private emails, paperwork, and make a, you know, because of their expert opinion, would make a case that Berkshire Gas was foregoing, you know, profits, short-term profits, for long-term profits by saying there's a moratorium and not having any other business plan that would supply customers with gas. And so we're not allowed to actually see the evidence. The evidence is between the expert and the lawyers and the judge and all that kind of stuff. So it's kind of...
Have you checked with counsel just to make sure that he's good with this?
Oh, yes. No, he's fine with us funding the... It can't say intervener, though. That's all.
All right.
Because what it is to hire...
Well, that was my concern. So.
To hire consultants.
Okay.
Kind of stuff. Sorry. We'll get it straightened out before, too long.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
We'll go over it again. Trust me. It will be another conversation.
Yeah.
So, and those are things that, thank you very much for highlighting them, but basically we don't have the wording right, and discussing them now is...
No.
Yeah.
And
no,
my recommendation will be that, you know, people come to us and tell us where they have issues that they think we need to focus on. Mm. But we have a lot of items here.
Yeah.
I would recommend that we get to a point where we've got an item that's a sticking point and we talk about it for 15 minutes or so, and we're not going to resolve it.
Right.
We take it to another night.
I appreciate you pointing it out. Was there any other one?
Can I finish, please?
Oh, sorry.
Just once.
I was just trying to follow up to make sure that we checked them all off. Sorry, Mark. I didn't mean to cut you off.
Mark, I understand what you're saying.
Yeah, if we can take it so that when we get into that meeting, if there's things that are not answerable at that point in time, we'll agree to disagree and then take it to a separate night where we're not jeopardizing the whole forum.
Yeah.
And
actually, that's a really good
solution.
We'll
sit there and go, okay, you know, this one, it might be two or three things on that night instead of the whole agenda item. Those things that are open, we'll just carry them and have a discussion on it. So,
actually, that is an actually good idea, Mark. So, Doug, can you schedule the meetings so that we have a select board meeting between the town meeting and our informational night, so that we can address as a follow-up anything that came up on the informational? In other words, backtrack from our town meeting and special town meeting, the select board meeting, and then that's the date before we want the informational night before that last selectman's meeting, so that we can follow up on anything that wasn't resolved satisfactorily on that information night.
You do understand that you can't change the warrant at that point.
No,
The article can't change. The scope of the article can't change.
The motions can change. We can take into consideration what the townspeople are talking about. We can change the motion, or we can pass over it if it's controversial and pick it up at some other.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah,
but
I would like a select meeting. I think that, Mark, is a really good idea because we should have a select board meeting.
I think that
up. We
might want to move the meeting before the meeting, the select board meeting, to before. So that basically when we're talking about it, we've got more time to, as Doug says, look at what we can do about it. So
I think last year we had the informational night. It was a week before the...
Yeah, but I think this time it'd be nice to have one. If we're going to use the 18th as the date for opening and closing, this one that we look at somewhere in that general vicinity, shortly thereafter, finding out where our pitfalls are. And again, it might be that night on the 18th, people can come in and talk about what our proposed items are, and we can get a sense of what we have to do more expeditiously and bring those to the table for discussion. Doug's point is very valid, is, you know, we would rather go in with a car that's not dented and be able to drive it nicely through the whole process than we would carrying the damaged things through the process of not being fixed.
It's not that we want to shortchange the town meeting or the special town meeting,
right.
But the problem is when you extend the warrants or the town meeting to the second night,
mm-hmm.
you get different crowd.
Yeah.
You can alter what you've done the first night. And I mean, there's whole potential more issues.
Right.
And you might not even get hardly a quorum even. So it's...
I understand.
We really try to...
That's not predictable.
It's getting harder and harder to do all our business in one night, but it is really worth it if we can try.
Would a Saturday work
compared
to an evening?
You're talking about town meeting?
Yeah, we try... Yeah.
It's codified in the bylaws that it has to be open on the last Monday in April.
We had talked about doing that, but there really wasn't... It was a couple years ago, but there really wasn't a lot of interest to do it on a Saturday. People generally didn't want to.
Right.
We I forget how we did it, but we did some kind of poll, informal poll, and asked people to respond. And
mm-hmm.
we talked about it two or three, a few meetings, and asked people to comment to the select office. And,
right.
you know, it was just nobody seemed to be too interested on Saturday. A lot of sports events were on Saturday, so people felt stressed. The families who couldn't come, on during the week because they got to take care of their kids, but then people were tied up with sports on weekends, and so it, generally we decided to keep it.
Just seems like there's a lot of articles, that's all.
I know, it's a really a lot of articles. But that's why I think
you have to, you know, you have to address them, so there's no way around that.
I know, but that's why I think
it's
the information
actually, it's actually less than we normally do.
Yeah, I know.
For this thing, so
I just see some of them I think could generate some more additional conversation, let's put it that way, time.
That's the nature of the beast. We have that every year. We have somebody who wants to get up and rattle the saber. Can we move on to the next item?
Before you do, I apologize. I'd like to suggest that one more article will likely go on to, I'm guessing, the special. It was the addition of I don't know if it's going to be a bylaw or a policy regarding roads.
Oh, yes.
Remember we had talked about I'm not sure if we were talking about a policy or a bylaw.
No, it's a bylaw.
Okay. That is not yet on either of these, and so that will need to go on them, on one of them. And it.
So I make a motion that, did you get the correct bylaw from Conway?
I do have a draft bylaw from
okay, Conway, because Conway's road bylaw was the bylaw that was amended. The original, FERCOG had come up with an example, and then what happened is Conway went through their town meeting process, and in the process they amended it to exclude agricultural and forestry work so that nobody that was doing business.
Give the people out there what you're talking about.
Okay. This is a bylaw, road bylaw, to reimburse the town for any roads damaged by heavy equipment that like the electric repair work that's going along the transmission lines. We have huge, huge amounts of damage to some of our roads, and they're just not built to carry the heavy equipment. And the electric company has been willing to talk to us. Kevin and I have met with them, and we have gotten some commitment of funding, but this bylaw will protect us in the future from heavy equipment if the pipeline goes through, or additional electrical transmission work, or whatever. Any big construction project that they use our roads, it documents the condition of the road. They are required to document the condition of the roads prior to their use and then restore it to that level of condition or better. It's crush culverts, replace crush culverts because the equipment is so heavy that it squishes the culverts, which has happened. The pavement, just there's a lot of the smaller roads don't have a base, strong base, and the pavement has just literally crumbled into rock, and it's fractured.
That's
kind of thing.
The extent of it is for damage because of heavy equipment, or is there a caveat to blasting or noise or any of that other stuff?
No, this is just strictly the road condition of the road. I'm not bringing forward the Dick and I have had as Board of Health have had significant experience with noise complaints, and I'm not bringing the noise bylaw forward without
nuisance and noise. Okay.
Without for a huge review by the planning board, by committees, and there's just not enough time to have significant input.
So
input
we're
on
going
that
to
one.
Input this into the article in there for heavy equipment passage on town roads for damage control. So you'll come up with appropriate words and put it in place. So
I second that.
That makes it 29 at this point in time. So 30.
30 articles even. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Doug, could you...
Can we go back to the...
Yeah, could you just circle that bylaw to everybody, the planning board, Dick, everybody just...
And the Board of Selectmen, if you're the ones who are going to be sponsoring the bylaw change, we'll need to do a public hearing on that.
Yeah.
That just needs to be announced a week ahead of time. It's pretty easy.
Why don't you put it on for the 23rd?
I can do that.
And get it to the police department, too, please.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I know Kevin has had some input already, but just make sure Kevin is okay with the final draft.
March 23rd. And I'll make sure that, we'll just say that that article is added to the warrant as of now.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, Doug, for tracking down the Conway version. That's the one that we want.
So can we get onto the agenda since you were
yep.
in such a hurry to get home?
I know. I
am I glad you shared this one.
Okay.
So we're at the regulation for article, or I don't know what REQ means, but.
Oh, requirement for articles related to SCIMS.
SCIMS. Do you have something you want to update on this, Doug? Or is it just a discussionary thought process, or what do you
think? I'm sorry, what do you have? I don't have the agenda right in front of me.
There you go. You want to check it. It's article.
Okay. Yes, I apologize. I just wanted to make sure
that... Take that one with you so you got
copies. Yeah, just in case. I wanted to make sure that both of you were aware of... These are articles on the main town warrant, the town meeting warrant. It's specifically articles 13, 14, and 15. 13 I put there as a placeholder. This was after discussion. I was talking with Mark a little bit about it. This was a result of some discussion with Zach Smith, and we were talking about the intermunicipal agreement, and he actually expressed to me some concerns about it, simply in that there's a lot of language in there that binds not only the EMS service, but also the Board of Oversight and the three towns to in certain ways that isn't necessarily advantageous to any of those parties. And that started a conversation between him and I, and we passed the agreement back and forth, and he had some markups with red pen, and I had some markups with red pen. And at that point, I stopped and I said, you know, before this goes any further, I'm not qualified to rewrite this agreement, but I think it is something that might be worthy of going on the town meeting warrant. More to the point, worthy of going before the Board of Oversight for South County EMS for consideration. And I wanted to make sure that the ability to take it up at annual town meeting was present, was there. I think that, especially going into year three, there might be some changes that could be made that will definitely benefit all parties involved, all three towns as well as the service. So that's the source of Article 13.
But I don't understand how we could, as a town, this and this have to come from the Board of Oversight?
It changes to the IMA. It actually has to be be approved by all three towns.
When do the other towns' warrants close?
Later than ours.
Oh, okay.
By a little bit.
All right.
I'm
no,
also
that's
meeting
fine.
Tomorrow with Sherry Patch and Mark Prohinsky to field this and a few other ideas by them to see what they're okay. thinking about.
This came from it was also a recommendation from the Board of Oversight to evaluate this.
Okay.
Because we're running into languages.
Mark, then that's fine. I just didn't understand how we would put this on our town warrant without other.
No, we're trying to coordinate. We're trying to make sure that all three towns do exactly the same thing so that it's the.
Okay, then that's fine.
Articles 14 and 15 are put there also in that same vein. Article 14. Is there at the strong recommendation of both our town accountant and Mark Abrams, who both suggest that each town meeting in each three towns will need to act to vote to create essentially a stabilization fund for the South County EMS. That will have to be a separate article at town meeting, and that's Article 14, a placeholder for that. Article 15 is the funding article for South County EMS.
Okay, but if you create this South County Emergency Management Capitalization Fund, you're not funding it. We have voted to fund capital.
We have voted to appropriate capital.
Right. So wouldn't you want to transfer that funding from appropriation that we have approved
that may
in prior
be part,
years?
That may be part of the motion.
Oh, okay.
And again, this—I don't even have the language
for the motion yet. I don't even know what it'll look like.
Well, I just, we
didn't have any place to put stabilization money other than the fact it was a line item thing. So this is something that we're trying to bring a closure to. How do we pay for an ambulance and how do we...
Oh, yeah. No, Mark, yeah. I absolutely agree. I just thought there was no funding attached. But
there will be two funds. One will be a capital improvement that we'll use on through the budget.
Okay.
And the other one is a stabilization fund that allows us to buy, you know, work on an ambulance or work on things that are going to cost a lot of money that we want to
put money aside
for 3 or 4 years to make sure that the money's there to...
And so the motion will include the funding where the, you know, that you, how you're transferring the
Transfer the fund.
Okay.
As much as I want to say yes, I don't know.
No, that's right. I was actually asking Mark because I was just, you create these accounts, but then you don't, you know, I was worried there was no funding.
Right.
So
it's in our budget this year to put money into those type of funds, but it's
you have to create the account.
We don't have the account now. It's part of the operational budget, and at the end of the year, it goes into unencumbered funds or whatever it is, which is different, which is the same thing as free cash. And it looks like we're hoarding a lot of money for no reason at all.
Right. So. No, absolutely, I understand, Mark. That's fine. I just wanted to make sure we had the ability to transfer the funding. That's all.
That will likely be a part of the motion. Okay. I mean, reason suggests that that's what will happen. But I will say that over the next 2 to 3 weeks, I will be getting a crash course on enterprise fund management from both Brenda as well as Mark Abrams.
Okay.
So that's coming.
And the last article will be on the special one, which is the article that we are going to pay past bills that are owed to the town of Deerfield.
Correct.
For managing of the funds and shortfall in the...
I thought that was on the special.
It is on the special.
Oh, okay.
So I said that we're talking about all the ones that are in here for SCEM. So we have four articles that are proposed at this point, whether all four get used or not. Doug will figure it out.
If we do this on the special, then the money goes into our free cash. That it should be certified in the fall. That's correct?
Yes, because you get paid out of this year's money.
Yeah, if we do it on the special, we use free cash that's currently available.
Perfect.
Or any other. Or, I'm sorry, the retained earnings from South County EMS.
Right.
It will be certified in the fall and be available. Okay.
Yes.
No, that's fine.
Yes.
I just wanted to verify that.
There you are.
The petition articles at the end. Oh, does there anybody have any questions about SCEMS?
I don't think there's any other articles that deal with SCEMS directly.
No, but are there any questions from anybody that has questions about the ambulance service? So let's move on
I personally don't.
Huh?
I said I personally don't.
Yeah. We can move on to the next one, which is the review of petition articles.
Well, there's a few articles on the annual warrant that I would like to point out. They're not necessarily petition articles, but they're not the boilerplate things. Articles 23 and 24 are coming from you, Carolyn.
Yeah.
Article 25 and 26 is related to the Lake Street Development Partners solar project on River Road. One is essentially a ratification of the net meter credit purchasing agreement that has already been signed and approved. And it was town council's suggestion that it would be a good idea to have town meeting ratify it. The second one is to authorize the selectmen to enter into a structured tax agreement. This is something that the Board of Assessors are still working very diligently on to try to get that agreement solidified and in a place where it can be adopted. But that would have to be adopted by town meeting because it would be a 20-year, 25-year agreement.
And do you think the assessors will have that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, they've made great progress, and kudos to John Kuder for actually getting a great deal of information together and bringing some sense to what seems to be a senseless mess of numbers. It's kind of a chaotic mess.
I know. So I was hoping, could you ask John to be able to speak to this? So because he would be able to explain this.
At town meeting, you mean?
Yes.
Oh, absolutely. Sure. Okay.
I just feel like he's sort of like the expert on this now.
Sure.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
One of the regional experts, as a matter of fact.
Article 27 is something that was put onto last year's warrant and voted, but I left it there with the hope that Oh boy, how to explain. Dick Kalischewski has a stack about an inch tall of various town properties that could be sold. They're slices of land that aren't being used, smaller, you know, 8-acre slices or quarter acre slices or half acre slices that wound up being in the town's hands at one time or another that we're simply not going to use. So I put this as a placeholder article in case you as the board wanted to consider requesting that land be offered up to for sale. We are doing that with two of the corners, if you will, of the Oxford property, as well as two lots up on Upper Road. There's also the potential for three lots on Stillwater and Sand Gully Road that will be sold hopefully in the early to mid-summer.
And we're moving forward on that, right?
We are moving forward, yes. As a matter of fact, giving a shout out to Vern Harrington, he will be very happy to know that we are moving forward starting tomorrow with disposition of those properties at the Oxford,
okay.
The old Oxford
site. I know he's not here tonight, but
right. It's anticipated that those four properties that we're putting up this spring could potentially earn the town about an additional $200,000. Rough estimates. That's my target. If we get more than that, I'll be thrilled.
Okay.
So I want to keep that going if we can next year, and I will be working with Dick Kalischewski to come up with some recommendations for town-owned land that might be disposed of without impact.
Is there an article on what we're selling?
Article 27 on the regular town meeting warrant.
That's to get rid of the small
right.
slices.
Correct.
But is there... I think that if we're selling pieces of property that's in the town, that we should probably use the money towards the betterment of the property we already own.
I don't disagree.
I want to think about how we structure that kind of a comment.
I don't
or,
know.
Or not.
Yeah, I'll have to check with Brenda to see if we can designate proceeds from a sale to a specific
fund. That's
what
we did. That's the reason. That's where you get the money to deal with the senior center and everything else.
Oh, I don't disagree.
Absolutely. That
right.
came from the sale of
I think we called it the Municipal Building Fund.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we could rename it, but...
No, the Municipal Building Fund is... I think that we have a lot of stuff that's going to happen to buildings in the town, and if we get money that we're getting from selling properties, then I think the money should go into, like we did back 25 years ago, and I commend them for doing it, is put that money into...
Sure.
How to take care of our buildings and maybe buy property that we're going to use for something else.
You're absolutely correct. I agree definitely with the intention. I'll see how we can do that.
That would be great.
Yeah.
Not getting off subject too much, but I do actually have a question. Was Kevin able to submit to the CPA committee some historical renovation costs related to the senior center?
We were not able to, no.
Okay, because we don't have enough information, or what was the deal?
There was not enough time to put together an application for the CPA. If we wanted to do that, we would have had to start back in, like, November.
Okay. Kevin is aware of this next cycle that...
I am aware of the next cycle, yes.
Okay.
And the effort to put together an application for use of CPA funds is going to be, it's going to extensively off, sorry, it's going to extensively involve this office. So I feel that it's certainly going to be part of Kevin's input will be to determine exactly what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. But getting all the materials together, the background information, documenting the historical nature of the building is going to be essential.
We were... Legitimately, the CPA funding should be used in some of that restoration work.
Without a doubt. Without a doubt.
Well, we've got enough to do that we probably can pick it up at the end of the fall.
I know, we'd use the whole fund,
I'm not just saying it. No, but we have enough time to put together a real plan for the building without asking for money that we really don't know.
Oh, no, I agree, Mark.
So
I agree.
I think we have enough time, and we're in the queue to do it.
We could drain the fund.
I wish John Paresky were still here, because I think that's part of his intention going forward after town meeting is to start looking at not only the long-range plans for equipment, but also for town facilities.
We're going to have a meeting within a month of the town meeting.
Absolutely.
The Capitol Committee will meet, and that was where we had talked about giving Kevin was going to do some kind of study or request some kind of money for a study so that we had all the renovations together for the request for the senior center this next coming year.
That was my hope to be able to put
together. I just didn't know if he was able to get anything in this cycle.
No, it wasn't possible.
Okay. No, that's fine. I wasn't sure what was in the cycle.
Okay. The last article that's on the warrant number 29 came in as a petition. And similar to the previous petition that came through, it was put onto the warrant verbatim. This is instructions to the moderator. There it is.
Well, we should say some people understand that basically this is an instruction to the moderator to appoint a municipal government study committee to examine the town's present form of government and determine whether or not it is the form of government best able to suit the town's future needs. Said committee shall be composed of at least 5 members, but not more than 7 members. Each member shall be a resident of the town and or voter of the town of Deerfield. I don't know if you can be one without the other, but the committee shall report its findings and recommendations to the annual town meeting in 2017.
That's a lot to do in 1 year.
Huh?
That's a lot to accomplish in a year.
Well, they can report their progress. They don't have to. They don't have to win.
True.
They can just say, "Hey, this is as far as we got." So,
one thing I would like to do, with your permission, is I will work with the proponent of this article to help draft a motion to make this happen, and also determine whether or not he's anticipates funding for this committee. Whether he wants the committee to have funding of some kind, and if so, we need to appropriate for it. So.
Absolutely.
Okay. Is there any other thing?
I think that closes out both our special town meeting and our review of the annual warrant.
Okay.
So anybody has questions or concerns?
All right. I'll entertain a motion, Mark.
For what?
To close the warrant
for annual.
Okay. I move to close the warrant.
I'll second that. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of closing the annual town meeting warrant? Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.
Doug, since we just got the special town meeting warrant, and we're going to open it and close it on the 18th, I don't think we have to do anything more on that, do we?
No, I think we discussed it enough.
I'm okay with it. I just want to look at it.
I would certainly welcome input from either of you separately on anything else that you think should go there. I will get the road bylaw language for the annual town meeting warrant, which that'll be an article on the annual town meeting. But I also need to consult with the planning board because at least one of those articles on the special is driven by conversations that they were having. I need to get the details on it.
Okay.
I thought that there was going to be a second one, a second article submitted by the planning board, but my understanding is that they are choosing to not submit that. That being said, there may be a citizen's petition coming along to do exactly that, or a recommendation from one of the town officials to add an article to that. So I'll have more information for both of you.
Okay.
And, well, for the board soon.
All right.
Doug, when will you have the updated version available for the public, do you think?
The warrant?
Yeah.
When it's published. The wording of the articles are going to have to go through about 5 or 6 different hands. The financial articles will go before Brenda. The legal articles will have to go before, well, the whole document will have to go before town council. I'm going to have to consult with Mark Abrams related to the funding article for, funding articles, plural, for South County EMS. And I'm going to have to consult with town's council in regard to the other articles, particularly those that relate to bylaw changes and the release of, disposal of town-owned land. I'm going to need to consult with a proponent of the petition
to make sure that the article is exactly as he wants, and I expect the next draft will be the final draft of the warrant. So, there we are.
Okay. Next item on the agenda of our next meeting dates, March 18th at 3 o'clock, March 23rd at 6:30.
What's so the 18th?
That's a Friday.
It's a Friday.
Okay.
Dave will be back in town. And then the next time that he's back in town is April 1st, right?
Oh, David?
Yeah.
He should be back on March 18th.
Yeah, March 18th, but I meant...
Oh, and then after that, it'll be 3 weeks later, so it'll probably be
April 1st? I'm not sure.
March 18th, 25th, probably April 8th.
April 8th? Okay.
I believe so.
All right.
Oh, am I looking at the right? 9th, 18th? I think April 8th.
Wow. Okay. So we'll have to... Okay.
Shoot. Okay. One thing, actually, looking at the calendar, and I apologize. I think, and I need to apologize through you to the Finance Committee, because there was a request from the Chair of the Finance Committee to schedule or to request a joint meeting between the Finance Committee and the Board of Selectmen prior to town meeting to sort of touch base on budgets and that sort of thing. I tentatively suggested April 1st, but I think that if David Wolfram wishes to be involved, we would have to put that off a week. I'm not sure where my brain was. I wasn't counting weeks properly or something. So that meeting would tentatively
be... No, it just seems like to go to April 8th as we're running out of time.
Right.
Can we do it on the 18th?
I can consult with Dylan to find out if that's possible.
Yeah. We can meet after our meeting. You know, it means a lot for us because it makes us a long day, but we could do our meeting and then move into the meeting after that. So we could schedule them for 4:30 or 5 o'clock.
Yeah, 5 o'clock, maybe.
If that's okay with David.
I will check with Dylan tomorrow and find out if that's possible.
Yeah.
Okay. And then I will poll the three of you to make sure.
Well, the thing is, I would post it, and if we cancel it, that's fine. If we can't get a quorum for people to show up, then... But I think that in the spirit of getting information out there, if we just have an informal discussion at that point in time, at least... At least it will update people as to what we're thinking and where we're going.
Well, we want to make sure that, we're all on the same page. So yep. I would, if we could do the 18th, that would be all right. Can you do the 18th, Jeff, offhand?
The 18th?
Yeah.
I can't speak for the committee, but...
No, I was asking you individually. Do you think...
You're important.
Does it look like you're available on the 18th?
I'll make myself available. Oh,
okay. Well,
thank you.
Thank you. I just kind of hate to wait till April 8th. That's all. I was thinking about that timeline for our informational meeting. So we would have. I would want to meet with this finance committee before we had an informational night.
Do you have a time that you're looking at?
We posted our Selectman's meeting at 3 o'clock, so if maybe at 5, something like that.
Whatever. And
okay.
I'll definitely try to make that. And
right.
But I can't speak for the finance.
Oh, no. Doug will send out an email, but right. I just didn't know if you would be available right away or whatever.
We're coming up very quickly on, and I'm looking forward at the calendar. March 18 is that Friday. The next your next regular meeting, the warrant date would be the 23rd of March.
Yep.
2 weeks after that would be April 6th. And 2 weeks after that would be April 20th. My recommendation would be to hold the information session on either the 18th or the 19th, or Monday or Tuesday evening, prior to your meeting on the 20th?
I actually would like to make it a week earlier than that.
So on the 12th or 11th?
Or that week. Because I feel like if we wait until the 18th or 19th, we have no time to adjust. Or, you know, we have very limited time. If we have an informational night
okay.
the week before, you know, like a Wednesday or Thursday the week before... then, I mean, I don't really care if it's Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, whatever, but...
I was thinking Tuesday because that would be convenient for members of the Finance Committee. I know they normally meet on
well, then
the
that's day. Fine. That's fine.
Meeting before that one? The Tuesday before. When's their meeting before that?
Your meeting is on the 6th?
No, their meeting.
Oh, the Finance Committee?
Right now we're meeting the 18th with both the Finance... We're asking for the Finance Committee to come to our meeting. And we're going to review the annual and the special on the 18th of March.
Correct.
The following Tuesday...
is the 22nd of March.
If we wanted to really follow up on what we did on the 18th, we could probably meet on that Tuesday.
Oh, no.
Just carry
we were
it through.
Talking about the...
the public information session.
Not the meeting with the Finance Committee.
But if we're really going to open it, there's two things. I vision the informational as the presentation from the boards, the Finance Committee, the CPA, the Board of Selectmen, to say, this is what we've come up with. There's not going to be a lot of discussion at that, and that can happen any time before the annual town meeting. But right now, the way Jeff is posturing himself is the fact that there's going to be grand discussions, and if we hammer them now, we're going to have the meat and potatoes on the table on the 18th of this month.
Oh, yeah. Well,
the following Tuesday, the Board of the Finance Committee is going to have their meeting. We could if we felt at that time that we have enough discussionary thought processes on the 18th, we could carry our meeting to that following date.
So you're saying sort of like not continuing your meeting, but well, you could actually, technically, you could continue it to the 18th if the discussions were ongoing and you wanted to continue.
That's what I mean. Start now and meet with the Finance Committee and have capital if they want to, and a lot of people are already pressed.
I have Tuesday nights is the Municipal Coalition Against the Pipeline meetings in Greenfield.
Every Tuesday night?
Not every Tuesday night.
But you're not going to be able to make any of the Finance Committee meetings.
No,
what I'm trying to say is
I will make a Finance Committee meeting if we have to, but if we could not schedule a joint meeting on ahead of time, if we could do it on a Wednesday instead or...
Well, I think we're going to have that following Wednesday, a Thursday, Wednesday, we're already going to have a meeting scheduled.
On the 30th.
On the 23rd is what it says here, right? You're talking April, I'm talking March.
Oh, I apologize. Yes, you're correct. You're absolutely correct. On the 23rd.
On the 23rd,
yes.
We're going to have a meeting. So if the Finance Committee said, yeah, we'll push off our meeting to the Wednesday night when we have a meeting, then we could do that.
Yeah.
But if they want to have it on their meeting, then they've come to ours, we should come to theirs and be fully capable of being flexible to it. I'm just looking for, there's a lot of angst that are running around right now. I'd much rather hammer it now than have it procrastinate out for a whole
Mark,
month.
Mark, that's fine. I'm just saying I do have a meeting on the 22nd
yep.
already.
Well, taking that
of
into
March.
Consideration.
Of March.
And again, if you can't make it, then we have a really good reason for asking the Finance Committee to meet. I'm meeting on Wednesday night because
23rd.
We can't have a meeting without you.
Well, yeah, that's right. I'm the quorum.
You're the quorum.
Or you're the quorum. Or the
so
yeah.
If I show up, it's of no value to the meeting if you're not there.
Right.
So if
well,
we
I
can
do
get
have
them
a scheduled
to,
meeting on
yeah,
the 23rd.
If they can continue on the 23rd, then we'll just have the meeting. All I'm looking for is to give you a heads up that I think it's better for us to follow the articles as they go. And if people are ready to talk about it and we have to go get information and come back to the table, then let's do it quicker than later, because all it's going to do is build animosity rather than solving the problems.
No, I will get the schedule for MCAP. I know there's one on the 22nd.
Okay.
But we generally meet Tuesday, so that's because nobody has a selectman's meeting or Northfield has a selectman meeting every other Tuesday, but we work around Northfield.
Okay.
So maybe I can reiterate. Next meeting is March 18th. That's Friday.
Yep.
We're going to try to do a joint meeting with the Finance Committee.
If they'll allow us, yep.
Yep. March 23rd, 6:30 p.m. This is your next regular meeting after that. It could also serve as a continuation of a joint meeting with the Finance Committee.
Well, I think that reality, we're only going 4 days, 5 days between Friday and Wednesday.
Right.
We shouldn't have a lot of things on our agenda for that Wednesday.
Correct.
Because usually we post everything on Fridays for what we're going to do on Wednesday.
That's our hope.
So it'd probably be an ideal time to have a joint meeting if they can't meet Friday, because we're going to have a limited agenda for that Wednesday. So we can throw two thoughts at them. They can meet either one of those days.
Okay.
Then we can make that be the starting point of our discussion. So.
Okay. I will consult with Dylan and see what he would like to do.
Perfect.
I do know the chair is scheduling, different people will come in for the Finance Committee. So
on Tuesday nights, correct.
Right, yeah. So that'd be good, Doug, if you could send the chair an email.
Yep.
Oh, he would. He would. Coordinate.
Yeah, yep. And we should probably send it to all the members.
Your next regular meeting would be on April 6th. That's a regular Wednesday. And then scheduling the information session for April 12th,
okay.
Which is a Tuesday night.
Oh. Can we make it the 13th?
If you'd like to do it on the 13th, that's up to you. I was thinking not a Wednesday, simply to allow you the ability to schedule your regular meetings on the Wednesdays, the 13th and the 20th, which gives you two full meetings prior to
the meeting. Oh, yeah, I see what you're saying. Well,
we could do it on the Monday, the 11th.
No. We'll do it on the 12th. I'll just not go to the meeting. The other meeting.
We may be in a good enough shape that basically all we're doing is a presentation.
Yeah.
And that's what it should be. At that point in time, it should be, we've already worked out all the details, and here's the two sides of the subject. And it should be them going home, making up their minds who they want to follow.
Well, and one of the reasons we've had so many meetings is because we're getting ready for the DPU hearings on March 30th. So,
okay,
we might not have one scheduled on the 12th. So I don't want to say that I have a meeting because I'm not sure if I do. I don't have my calendar here.
So because it'll be the day after the public information, I'll schedule a tentative meeting for the April 13th.
Okay.
It doesn't have to happen if you choose not to have it happen. And then your regular meeting again will be on the 20th.
But you know what? That's a good idea, Doug, because if we have issues that come out of the 12th, we can deal with them on the 13th, right. And it's already a posted meeting.
Yep.
Okay.
Your regular meeting will be on the 20th, and then, of course, town meeting on April 25th.
Okay. We are posting the second night for the 27th.
We're posting the second night for the 27th, and we're posting the third potential day for April 30th. Saturday.
Oh my God, 30, 3 days. Oh.
We are hoping, we are just reserving the space.
I know.
And it's that's at the request of Peter James. He said, please reserve the Monday, the Wednesday, and the Saturday, just in case. So.
Okay.
So we have.
Don't worry, we're going to have informational nights. Okay. Well, is there any other business that you have for us, Doug?
I wanted to just update you very quickly. We've touched on it already, but Kevin has been working on repairing a collapsed culvert on Mill Village Road. It was an 18-inch culvert, and I'm saying this detail also so our friends from the recorder can get all the correct information. I checked in with... yes, you. I checked in with Kevin later this afternoon after talking.
You did, okay. 18-inch.
It's an 18-inch culvert. We're pretty sure it's spiral-wound steel, although Kevin hasn't actually seen it yet. He's not sure. This is a culvert that was put in ages ago. It had a loose, dry-laid stone headwall that, as they were working and pumping some of the water out and around it, the entire headwall collapsed. The culvert he thought was just partially plugged was actually fully collapsed. The culvert, the metal culvert itself had collapsed. What he's done so far is through some good assistance from Cocott and Sons, he's brought an excavator up there. He rented a very huge water pump to pump some of the water out from the head side of the culvert to bring the water level down so he could work with it. And they have already installed a 4-foot diameter plastic culvert adjacent to the existing metal culvert. I want to mention that this project has been reviewed by both our local conservation commission as well as by the DEP. And Mark Stinson was really excellent in providing advice to Kevin as to how to proceed in the least impactful way, but in a way that actually will help to benefit the town.
I also want to thank Steve Barrett, because
very
Steve Barrett
so.
Is,
yes.
was very nice
he
to work
He was right
with
there
Kevin
within a day of requesting.
Mark Stinson, yes.
Yep.
That was very nice. It really was an emergency situation.
Yep. The road has been closed since, I think, the end of last week. It'll be closed probably throughout this week, but Kevin is hoping to have it reopened by end of day Friday. It's not a guarantee. It's just a goal. And by end of day Friday, hopefully he'll have it reopened for two-way traffic. There's that. As I mentioned before, the costs are going to be at least $20,000, likely over $30,000 or around $30,000, and he's already requested a release of Chapter 90 funds to cover the cost of this. This is just a fix. We're going to need to do a proper replacement of the culvert. That will be a $150,000 project later on, and Kevin and I are going to be talking about ways to find money, either through a MassWorks grant or through potential funding that is being proposed by the governor in his budget.
Friday, the Conservation District, which I'm chair of, voted to apply for a grant for $35,000 for technical assistance to assist Kevin.
Oh, okay, great.
So,
Is that in relation to identifying and mapping culverts that need replacement, or?
That's specifically for that culvert.
Oh, okay.
Because it's complicated, that whole watershed area. I mean, that it's plugging up.
It is.
It's backing up.
Yep. One thing Kevin did make very clear to me, and so I'm going to pass it on to you, is that while the culvert had collapsed, that wasn't the entire source of the problem there. The area between Mill Village Road and Route 5 to its east, and then the next road to the east of that, I don't remember the name of it, the one that parallels Route 5.
Whopping.
Whopping Hill Road. All of the water problems related to all the areas there. Part of it was the culvert, without a question, but between Mill Village and Route 5 and 10, there's something on the order of 5 or 6 separate beaver dams, which are also causing a lot of water to be retained in that area and reducing the capacity of that natural marsh to receive additional storm water. It's definitely affecting the flow of water as it moves down towards the Deerfield River, and is something that both he and I know that you and residents have repeatedly requested the state pay attention to, with no response at this point. So
I am going to call in tonight.
Can we authorize the trapping of the beavers?
We could if we own the land. It's owned by the state.
We're working on that.
Yeah, but we are working on that.
It's owned by the state?
That's Kevin's assertion.
Some of it isn't, and we're working on it, Mark.
Oh, there you go.
Drone is going up tomorrow. Chris Redmond from Gill's bringing his drone over, and it's going to take a picture of where the dam and water flow. Remember, this is, I don't know how many times we met with the state, and they were going to, we worked out a deal within a couple years ago. They were going to do permitting and engineering, and we were going to do implementation of the drainage. And what had happened when we had that landslide, a lot of silt came down, and it slowed everything down, and it slowed the drainage so that anytime water goes through now, it drops the silt. It acts like a filtration where it drops the silt instead of carrying it because the flow is so slow. And then beaver dams have moved in, and that's exasperated the situation. So it will be more complicated to fix. So you have to now address the whole area. And so we're working on it, trying to get as many partners as possible together. That's why the Conservation District wants to work see if there's any money available through NRCS, that kind of stuff.
But I think trapping out the beavers is a simple start to the process, because basically they're, as you said, it's, they're one of the contributors that are the easiest to solve.
Change the flow.
They change the flow and they dam up the water and the marsh is talking about. And if the state's not cooperating, or we need to get to whoever the bottom of that is, I think that's where we should.
Well, the silt,
put a lot of
silt
time.
Started the whole thing, remember.
I understand. Oh. I know that when the beavers threatened 91, the state took all the 15 minutes to authorize trapping and everything else. So here's a similar thing that's causing exacerbation of a lot of problems that I think that basically we should make sure that we echo that one. We're writing letters about bridges outside of our town. I think that basically we should have the newspaper put in print that beavers are not our friends in this application, and we should look at ways of...
Don't put that in the paper.
I got news for you.
We're looking into solutions.
You can quote me on the fact that in this application, beavers are not our friends. I mean, they may be furry, and do you like the way they look? But reality is,
we will sign the beaver removal permits, Mark.
Yeah, as soon as we can do that, we'll get that in front of us and go through and do it. We have the technology to make that happen fairly quickly.
A couple of other things I just want to mention, and I know that the hour is late, but I'll try to be brief. At a Finance Committee meeting last night, there was some discussion about about Kevin's budgets and about staffing, and the idea was posed that Kevin's crew might be able to be freed from some of the summertime mowing duties if he was enabled to hire some part-time or some temporary help. The idea being either high school seniors or college students who would be willing to mow lawns, essentially, at the various places around town. Kevin believes that if he could get a couple of people to work just through the summer, that it would free up most of his crew to do other essential things like the rebuilding of roads, repairing of culverts, the important essential work that they know they have to do. And so I'm going to be working with him just over the next week or so to find out if that's possible or if there's money available to do that. Teetering right on the over the edge into the budget, as it stands right now, without knowing the accurate numbers for South County EMS, and without knowing the accurate numbers for some of our human resources costs, our budget stands at, let's see, the operational budget stands at about $13,790,000. With all the other expenses, we are looking at a total operational capital and other budget of $15,683,710. That's holding back, or that leaves about $470,000 in free cash or other revenue unused at this point. That is putting nothing into stabilization, either capital or general stabilization, and that's only putting $80,000 to the reserve fund. This was accomplished by negotiating, or by basically moving some of the capital requests off of the FY17 budget, putting them off. I spoke with Kevin about the tractor that he had requested replacement of, and that the Capital Improvements Committee actually approved. I asked him if he could put it off a little while, perhaps till next fall. He said, yes, it's possible. I asked if there could be a postponement on the replacement of the air conditioners at the library, and Sarah Woodbury says, well, they work now, so yes. I don't have the authority to do that, but I wanted to find out if that was possible to do that. And in both cases, they said yes.
Why don't we talk with the Finance Committee about that? Because my understanding was the tractor wasn't in such a great shape. So
it's in lousy shape. Absolutely.
And a requirement of us to get highway funding, you know, the Chapter 90 money, is that we have to maintain the guardrails, you know, a trimming along
sure.
the guardrails.
Sure.
And that has to be done
yep.
summer, at least once or twice in the summer or fall. early fall. And if that tractor's not available, it might jeopardize our funding. If, you know, if it breaks down, because it's kind of in really
bad
shape.
Brand new tractor that they use for mowing side of the road, guardrails?
No, we have the arm is new, but the...
Yeah, this is, the brush hog is new, but the tractor itself is about 22, 24 years old.
It's in pretty
It's a John
shape.
Deere that has metal filings in the oil every time they change the oil. So,
I just, you know, it's a false savings to put it off for a couple months.
Well, it is. You're absolutely right. But again, I'm hoping to be able to dispose of some town-owned land, which would give us an additional $200,000 in free cash once it's certified near the end of the summer in 2017. And at that time, we could either do a special town meeting or otherwise be able to fund these projects. There was also the suggestion that the air conditioners may be able to be funded out of the municipal building fund instead of being funded through free cash. Which I haven't explored that yet, but that's something that has been talked about. I know that Brenda and Barbara will be...
Can we back up for a minute?
Sure.
And your original statement was this. Your budget is based upon, and if I correct me if I'm wrong, the assumptions of everything's in place, but you don't have numbers from the personnel...
Correct.
And from SCEMS.
Correct.
And those two items are probably $500,000.
Correct.
So...
Let me clarify what I just said.
Yeah, let me...
Let me clarify, and it will make sense.
Okay.
In the budget for South County EMS, there is a set aside of, I believe, $87,000 for retirement costs. And I'm going to go and pull up the budget just so I know what I'm talking about. I believe it is $87,000 roughly for retirement costs. When we build these budgets, South County EMS budgets for that retirement cost, and that amount is offset on Barbara's retirement appropriation.
Mm-hmm.
So where the total appropriation is about $500,000, we would subtract whatever is in that budget and say, okay, so now we don't need to appropriate $500,000, we can appropriate $413,000 instead, because the other $87,000 is coming from South County EMS. However, the number that Zach put in, that $87,000, does not agree with Brenda's estimates of $30,000, which means that not only does that throw Brenda's retirement budget off, it also throws off the South County EMS budget.
But this is a pass-through.
I'm sorry. It is a pass-through, but we want to make sure that the appropriation for both budgets is accurate so that neither Barb is shortchanged when she has to pay the bill and South County EMS isn't trying to set aside more money than they need.
All right. If they're putting more money aside for something that they do not need, and Barbara's right on for what she needs at $30,000, then we have basically over budgeted that will go into free cash, basically $50,000 is to be paid to the town of Deerfield for that funding. The reality is that no matter what the cost is, it's going to come from this pot to that pot, and if it's not used for that pot, it never comes out of our funding.
How can you have such a discrepancy when you have so many full-time people?
But it really doesn't matter, because basically it's a pass-through. It's something that basically somebody's going to come up with the right number, and it's going to correct it in the budgets on either side of it.
That's correct. You're absolutely right.
It shouldn't
If we were talking about the police department, just to pick a town department that's funded through taxation, this wouldn't be an issue, because whether we're paying $30,000 for retirement costs at the police department budget or we're paying it in Barbara's budget, it doesn't matter. It's the same pot of money that we're pulling the money from. When we're talking about South County EMS, there are two other towns that are providing funding for it, plus the fees that are earned by the service. Mm-hmm. So instead of us paying the entire amount,
the town
of Deerfield only needs to appropriate about 40% of that, 35 or 40% of that overall.
Okay, so I can see now that you could have
And most importantly, we made this mistake last year. We had a number like $83,000 or $86,000 in this line item last year. Barb was only able to account for about $30,000 of that. Therefore, she was only able to request about $30,000 of that from South County EMS. Therefore, her appropriation is short. She's going to have to come back at special town meeting and request a transfer from free cash of about $50,000 to pay for retirement costs. Because of we played the numbers game, we thought that, EMS would be paying more than they actually have to. We don't want to make the mistake again this time.
I understand that, but the number, whatever you come up with a number, the only thing that we're short this in this budget, true to fact, is that we don't have an agreement between benefits between South County EMS and Brenda. The rest of the budget is represented by what you said to us. Is that a correct statement?
Really, it's really not. It's really not. No matter what, we have to pay the whole retirement cost. Please let me finish. We have to pay the whole retirement cost, the $500,000, and we can request a transfer of some of that money from the EMS. Zach is budgeting for that money.
Oh, the 87. He's budgeting the 87.
If we only need to budget for 30 on the EMS budget, doing all the math, doing all the calculation, instead of the 87, it drops the Deerfield's. It drops his bottom line by that 53,000, and it drops Deerfield's assessment from 387,999 to 358,476. It drops our assessment that we would have to pay for South County EMS by $30,000. And it doesn't leave Barb shorthanded. So getting these numbers correct is important.
You're missing, you didn't answer my question at all. I ask a question, you explain to me something that doesn't reflect the question, doesn't help me.
And I don't understand the question.
That's what I tried to say before you told me that you had to finish explaining to me what I didn't want to know. It's a pass-through. It's something that when you figure out what it does, you're going to correct Deerfield's budget, Sunderland's budget, and Whateley's budget, and Brenda's budget's going to be solid. When you figure that number out.
Yes.
Okay. My question was simply, all of the other budget items, everything else from South County EMS, everything else from Brenda's account, everything else is reflected in what you told us prior to this conversation. The only discrepancy with the budget that we know right now is the fact that those two numbers have to be balanced out.
No. Once we get these numbers straight, it will affect the bottom line of Deerfield's budget.
Yes, absolutely, 100%.
And that's why I said that, because we don't know the South County EMS budget and the human resources benefits bottom lines, I can't say, I'm just saying that that's where our budget stands now. These aren't bottom line numbers.
You answered my question, but I get it. Right now, the bottom line is affected by those two separate little things.
Yes.
The South County appropriation for it and everything else.
Yes.
That was my question from the beginning. I got the impression from your conversation from 15, 20 minutes ago that SCEMS was not in here, nor was the discrepancy of the budget.
I apologize. That's where I was coming from.
And that's why I kept asking the question. You kept saying no, and I'm going, I'm missing it. Because basically all we're talking about, as you said, $50,000, and $50,000 we own 50% of it, so we're talking $25,000. So our budget, as you represented it earlier, is pretty close to what we'll be looking at as we correct and adjust for all of the other things that come in front of us.
It is pretty close.
It's dynamite, as far as I'm concerned.
It's a lot better now. Have years passed.
But I just want to make it clear that when we're talking about being in the black by only $400,000. Differences of $20,000 or $30,000 or $40,000 can make a big difference. So,
I'm usually
record is saying that basically $400,000, and
that's not taken into the fact that we should have $700,000 in free cash set aside, and unless you've already said, because at one point we talked that the Finance Committee had taken $250,000 or $200,000 and taken it off the table and said we're not going to consider that as any money that exists here. So $400,000 plus the $200,000 is $600,000, which is pretty good for free cash, but it gives us nothing in long-term stabilization or long-term capital improvements programs, and we're getting killed. We're getting killed at the school level. We're getting killed with the senior center. We're going to be killed with stuff at the library.
Yep. To speak,
we need to talk about getting, and this is where we're really, that $600,000 is nice, but
Mark, how old is this building here?
This building was built in 61 or 62, so it is...
It's in great shape for that old.
So it's over 50 years?
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Well, if it's over 50 years, then we can use CPA money on this, too.
But, Carolyn, you're talking about taking money because we have nothing for senior housing. We have nothing for all this stuff.
Well, I know we've been setting it aside, but what I'm saying is we do have CPA money for renovations if we have to.
Yeah, well, I mean,
because you were talking about the senior center, and this building is eligible as too, because we did the library, some stuff in the library, and this building becomes eligible too. That's
but the thing
huge.
Is, we start talking about money that's available. We don't talk about what our game plan is for how we want to be here. Because is this really a better building for a senior center? Is that building, when we renovate it, better for something than what we use it for right now?
I know.
We've got to start looking at not how to spend money, but how to get what we need and then spend the money on how to get there. We keep chasing dollars, and we don't look at, where are we going to end up 15 years from now or 20 years from now? And it's frustrating me. It's getting to the point where we're not putting any money away. We're being hit with these $3 million rebuild roofs because we have no choice because we have to go through the state bureaucracy to have something done, and I'm still a little concerned that we're spending almost as much money to repair the roof as we could do it if we did it on our own and probably save ourselves a couple $100,000. But it's not here nor there. We got to do it. We don't have the time. It's got to fit in a time frame. That's not the time to have that discussion. We should have the discussion back when they said the roof was going to fail and we're putting away peanuts. $50,000 a year doesn't do anything for us. The reality was that they should have been able to tell us that roofs were failing and that they were costing the towns millions of dollars, and then we should have thought of another tack to go because we obviously missed the boat on that conversation collectively. And I'm not blaming anybody, and I'm not looking to have the prolonged argument, but it's we got to really start planning our moves because we could save so much money if we do it smart rather than trying to figure out where to get more money to spend on something that makes it really nice, but it's not what we wanted.
I know.
So, I'm sorry. I got off my pulpit, but I appreciate your discussions, and yeah. I'm really thankful for the fact that our budget is so close, and I want to make sure that was clear because that's the way I understood it, but
yes.
I couldn't get you to just say yes.
It is close.
It's very close, but again, there's a lot of work to be done to get some money in to stay in free cash,
yep.
And to start a capital stabilization fund to fix some of these things.
I need to address two more things, and I do need direction on one of them. I was in attendance at the public hearing for the Frontier Regional School budget, and while the numbers that we got last night are not exact, the bottom line for the budget is the same as what I received this today from Patty Kavanaugh. For FY17, the budget that was approved was $10,107,421. It represents a 3.69% increase over last year. Although I believe I've got another number, 10,060,492. I'm not sure if that's accurate. I'm pretty sure the 10,107,421 is correct. Deerfield's assessment will go up no more than $287,614. And my understanding from Patty is that our assessment actually will be less than that slightly less than that because of the way they're using their excess and deficiency funds to offset some of these expenses. They're using $350,000 out of $450,000 in their E&D account, leaving only about $100,000 available to them for emergencies. This, I think, represents a significant sacrifice on their part. There was a lot of discussion last night about the impact of school choice and charter schools on the bottom line. Breaking it down, Deerfield's school choice numbers and charter school numbers are 17 students going out to, I'm sorry, let me just make sure I've got these numbers right. 17 students going out to charter schools and 16 going out to school choice, I believe.
How many school choice?
16.
The difference really comes down to the funding. When the district loses a student to school choice, they lose about $5,000 and change.
Yep.
When they lose a student to a charter school, they lose about $18,000.
I know.
And that disparity is costing an incredible amount of money. A quick bit of math shows that Deerfield's increase in appropriation is almost equal to the amount that charter school students costs the district. It's correlation is not causation, but it was an interesting similarity in figures.
Charter schools got public schools.
Yep. Marty Barrett regrets the atmosphere around school choice and how it affects school budgets everywhere, she came out very much opposed to the funding mechanism that charter schools enjoy or that the state has imposed as a result of charter schools, and strongly discourages or strongly opposes the expansion of the charter school limitations.
Could you ask Marty to write up a template letter and request all four towns send a letter to the governor and complaining about the charter school costs, funding?
I will do what I can to see if there's something that's available. I would not want to put more on her plate, but I will look around and see if there's something available, certainly.
Because, the governor is very pro-charter schools, and we already have a lot of issues.
His stances on charter schools where public schools don't exist or are underfunded, underachieving.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that the letters are very valuable and really need to be put in place, but did they tell us how many kids are coming into Frontier
from choice? A total of 129 students choice into Frontier, which results in an increase in revenue of about $878,000. However, a total of 36 charter students and 56 students choice away from Frontier, which results in a cost of $979,998, or a difference of about $120,000. We're in the hole about $120,000.
Right.
So.
But understand that we have to pay for both that charter and the schools going out. The money that comes back goes directly to the schools, and it doesn't come out of our budget. It doesn't offset one another.
I'm actually not really entirely sure of how that money works, but I know that the school choice money that the school gets is reduced by the number of students that choice out.
Right, but the charter comes off our cherry sheet.
The charter comes off the cherry sheet.
Yeah, before we get our funding.
Before we get our funding. Absolutely.
But the money in, the 160 so people don't come through the cherry sheet, they go directly to the school.
The 129 he's talking about.
Sure, I understand.
Yeah. No, he said there was 165 students.
Oh, I thought it said
that choice in.
I'm sorry.
129 students choice in.
So that's $800,000 that goes directly to the schools.
Right.
And the cost of charter schools is $656,000.
Which comes off our
money. Comes off the cherry sheet.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is it the cherry sheet or the Chapter 70 funding?
Chapter 70 money.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it comes off before it comes back in. I mean, comes before it comes
right,
to us.
Right. And that cost is $656,000 for all four towns. I'd have to do the math to figure out what it is specifically for Deerfield. I think it's about $300,000.
It's a lot of money, but again, it's not offset the money we see here. We pay it out of our money for the
for the kids that leave the school.
Right.
And go to charter. But the kids that come into the town, the school gets a whopping
$5,000 into the
school, and they can use it for whatever they want to use it. It doesn't have to be in the appropriations.
Right.
The reality is, and this is where the math gets real bad, is it costs us about $15,000 to educate a student. So to collect somebody's school choice, we get $5,000 that goes to the school, and we get to pay the school $15,000 to educate that student. There's a discrepancy there that is fuzzy math.
Sure.
That's why we started to trim back the kindergarten at elementary school. Right.
We appreciate that thought process. It really.
So we were spending, you know, we were funding another whole kindergarten class, teacher, IAs, all that. So we, you know, we figured the math, and if we could lose one of those classrooms and slowly, year by year, over 6 years, you know, reduce the class size, then you're getting back to, you know, something that's more affordable, but, you know, but you're losing all of that money too. So just the fundings in school and school of choice are killing.
It's a very
complicated. It's retirement, OPEB, all that stuff is not even accounted to.
Yeah. Discussion, and what I think that both Carolyn and I both want is a good education format.
Absolutely.
We want to support something that produces great education, and I think that we need to start thinking outside of the box, and because we're going to have space in our schools,
yes,
to do something with it.
Enrollment.
Now, I would love to see us do something that's similar to a charter,
right?
Where we do special needs and not special needs, but special projects in one of those schools locally, and STEM. Make that. Be income to how we get a much better education,
right.
And that could be anything from gifted to
sciences and math.
To math to music to whatever, and make that concentrated study, and make that go in the business of catering to keep our kids here,
absolutely.
And local, and bring kids here that would pay the charter rate,
exactly,
and then it's fair. I don't mind having a specialized school paying a little bit more for this, but right now they're out looking for the low-hanging fruit, and they're snatching it off, and it's gotten our school systems. And we need to support it and figure it out.
Do you know what charter schools the kids were heading to by any chance?
Well, generally, they're going to Chinese Immersion, Pioneer Valley Performing Arts, Four Rivers. That's pretty much it. Now, I'm on the collaborative board as well, and we've done a lot of study and work on how the charter schools really affect, you know, the rural communities.
Right.
I mean, it's understandable in Springfield, where you've got no choice of where your child's going to go, and it's a failing school. But here, we have wonderful schools. And charter schools do not educate any better than a public school. And you don't have to be a certified teacher to work at a charter school. There's so many rules and regulations that bind our public schools that charter schools don't have to deal with. And it's just the funding is wrong, the oversight. We have no local oversight of the schools.
Right.
They're have gigantic piles of money, and it's all for profit, you know. Yeah, so there's a lot going on. I've met with Stan Rosenberg in Greenfield. He came to meet with a lot of our superintendents and school committee members, and they're going through the legislature right now. They're deciding, you know, whether to, they know the push for the cap is coming, and there's millions of dollars to push for that because it's a for profit. So he's thinking, well, do we either fight that and hold back the cap, or if we do that, they're going to go around and have a ballot measure. If they do, if it passes by ballot and everybody says, oh, child school should be great, or charter school should be great, then we have no recourse. The legislature will never take up that funding again, or they'll never take up that issue if it passes by ballot. So they thought, better the devil you know than the one you don't. We should probably get some of the fixes that we've needed for 20 years, because it was supposed to be just a small kind of experimental, and then they share what they've learned back with the public schools, and they never do. They never come and tell us what works and what doesn't. So. I think that we're going to try and get legislation to attack some of these oversight things, taking, they bring kids in and then send them out just before MCAS. So the MCAS shows up, you know, the underpouring kids gets back to our district, MCAS scores get attached to our district instead of where they've been for the last 6 months. They only take a lot more girls than boys, because girls are great, you know, students. They don't have to take as many special needs kids. And most of our cost in our education right now are special needs. The preschool right now, the kids in preschool and the kids in kindergarten are, the needs of those kids, special needs, are so much greater with, you know, 504s or the or any of the special education, you know, to get them on reading, to, you know, ADHD or whatever the issues they might have. So just constantly, and then you lose this money out to a charter school, so now you don't have a reading recovery specialist to address these needs for the kids coming in. So
it's a revolving
cycle of disasters.
So the easy solution is to turn Frontier Regional into a charter school.
Yeah.
Is it possible?
I don't know. I think the best solution is to get, like you said, maybe do small kind of things to get our public schools attractive to people that might want to send their child to a performing arts school. Have those programs in our school. Fund them here so that we do this locally and the money doesn't go there. It comes to us.
Well, it's two-pronged. You know, you talked about the regulation or the oversight that needs to be put in place. Those things that you mentioned, those are criminal.
Mm.
And I think that basically we need to start going after the fraud of what it is.
Yes.
And the fact that this isn't, and public, just public information, this is what charter schools are doing for us.
Yeah.
They're not educating our kids. They don't have any better rate of getting kids to them. They may have a better rate if they cherry-pick the best students.
They do.
Which is fine, but the reality is they are being successful only because they have the ability to say no.
Right.
And public schools don't. So those, that
well, and there's no
verbiage needs to come
them.
Out, and
yes.
That accountability has to be presented in such a manner in which the average person can understand.
And it's public money. It's public.
Yeah,
this is what
fund private education.
Right.
If you want a private education, go pay for it.
I was just going to say, it's your choice to send your children somewhere, but
yes.
You pay for it.
Yes.
And for us, as taxpayers, that's what, you know, you talk about taxes, Jeff. This is where taxes, you're paying taxes,
I've
and you're
fine. I've talked about this for years.
Yeah.
This is terrible. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, the state keeps talking about changing formula and that. There's a lot of discussion about it, but there's no action on it.
Right.
And part of the reason being is because Boston doesn't need it. So
right.
Boston doesn't care. They're doing just fine. So the rest of the
Well,
state,
actually, what you have to do is you have to get enough people together to make a class action suit to force them to look at the formula, because over the years, you know, when I was first selectman, it was like 32-33% funding by the state of our cost of education. And now it's not even hardly 20%. And who's picked up the difference but the town's taxpayers?
Yes.
And we have less kids. We're spending more money.
Okay, that's another issue.
And the reason why the state
areas are
right
and the state
is not reviewing the funding formula, because they know if they review the funding formula, they're going to have to spend more.
Mm-hmm.
And so by just putting it off,
mm-hmm.
the ball it always ends up back in our court, and it's terrible.
And you have the political,
I know,
part of it, where they want to privatize education in this country.
I know.
And they don't want public education. So, you know, it's tough. It's a tough issue.
I know.
Just getting involved and getting my eyes open, but it's, and you have to get the buy-in from the parents of the charter school kids too, because a lot of them have no idea. They just think, hey, better education, better opportunity, and why wouldn't I want that for my child? But if they realize how it affects their town and everybody around them, and that maybe we could fund with enough grassroots efforts these programs in our local schools, keep that
Well, that was what's so exciting about the long-range planning committee. I'm not kidding. Those meetings were very exciting. I was really energized because instead of just saying, how do we protect the status quo when we know we can't sustain the status quo, it was like, right. Okay, how do we generate really great educational opportunities for our kids, going in 21st century stuff,
yes.
And making it exciting for kids to learn and want to go to school and right. Be happy about our education system and yet still be affordable.
Right.
And so, you know, I mean, so many kids move around now. Closing down an elementary school, one of the smaller elementary schools in a town and making it a math and science academy should be not such a big step like it used to be, you know, or changing the class formats or whatever. So you have sixth grade now at Frontier because you have room. And then you're bringing in some other kinds of programs at the elementary school or whatever. I mean, there was just so many neat ideas just floated around.
Yeah.
I was excited. I was, because it's just such a battle to try to, you know, come up to money to every year to fund the school. And all you're trying to do is just do the status quo every year.
And it raises every year with the teacher's steps and, you know, they're getting educated. It's tough. It's a tough issue for sure.
I hate to cut this short, but
yes.
Yep. I actually have one more question.
Sure.
I really need direction on this. Okay, if that's your answer. I need, at the meeting last night and after the elementary school public hearing on the budget last week, both the elementary school committee as well as the Frontier Regional School Committee stated that they would be unable to provide any funding for the school resource officer. I know that I've heard some pretty strong opinions at previous Board of Selectmen's meetings. So my question is, do you want to keep it on the police department budget?
Do we know where the New England Patient Network is at? Application?
We're waiting for a final contract from them. That's looking good. It's coming together. We won't expect to see money on that in FY17. Or at the very least, it won't be money that we can use to fund this position this coming year.
How much are we short salary-wise?
It'll be a total of about 30s, and I hope, I don't know if the chief wants to run down here at 9:30 at night. Probably not. I believe it's somewhere around $30,000, $35,000. We have $30,000 from Deerfield Academy. The chief was asking for $20,000 from the schools to cover the remainder of the salary, and the town was going to be picking up the estimated HR costs of $16,000 to $18,000, maybe a little more. So it's more like $35,000 to $40,000.
Well, keep it on the budget keep it on the agenda for the 18th. Let's see if we can. Eaglebrook isn't contributing to this right now, is it?
We've received only the $30,000 donation from Deerfield Academy.
Let's see if we can get a donation from Bement and Eaglebrook to whittle it down a little. Okay. And then we'll bring it up for the 18th. How's that?
Well, I think it's probably appropriate for us to give a statement. I mean, I have a real hard time with two school committees' budgets at $15 million, which is larger than our whole budget. They can't find the money for a school resource office, which basically is one of their major resources. We're kicking in $16,000, and Deerfield Academy is extremely generous in giving us $30,000. I really have a hard time with us trying to take money out of different pots and do this to fund something that the people who had the best benefit from it aren't willing to take up even 25% of the cost of having a resource officer in place. And they're asking for, and I'm glad to hear that they came down from their over 5% budget process, but we're below 2.5%, and everybody else is figuring out how to make the things work that really need to work. I really don't understand how they can say that something that's valuable, or at least is expressed as valuable, is not worth them trying to figure out where to put the money into, money into the process. I think that if we go back to the chief and really look at the person that's taken the place of the resource officer being the lesser of the two evils, the money should come down a little bit, and there won't be as big a margin, but because his budget is increasing by
about $46,000.
A new person.
Correct. His budget also doesn't include the HR costs.
Right, but the thing is, you're saying $65,000. If we're saying that's the cost of having a new patrolman on the things, then you know, we're kicking in the $16,000 to make it work from the town side of it. The nonprofits are kicking in things, and we can go look for other nonprofits to give us more money. I think it'd be more appropriate for the schools to go talk to Eaglebrook and other people to help them do that, because they're the ones that's getting the direct benefit out of it. We've paid our part, and I think that us chasing that money is just enabling them to say, okay, you know, they're putting us between a rock and a hard place. I think it's extremely valuable. I think it's the one thing that we've done in a lot of years that has the potential of stopping a lot of immeasurable things.
I absolutely agree with you, Mark.
I think that we need to ask them to, okay, you don't have the money. Give us some ideas how you expect us to pay for it. Or come to me and tell me it's not valuable. If that's the attitude, if it's not valuable, then come tell me that, and we'll not spend the money on it.
The one possibility, I want to try to be as constructive as I can. One possibility is, I've got a meeting tomorrow morning with the two town administrators of Whately and Sunderland. I can talk to them about whether or not they have some extra money in their budget that they could squeak out a payment to assist us with this. And if we could get $8,000 or $9,000 from Sunderland and maybe $3,000 or $4,000 from Whately and maybe $5,000 from Conway, then we've got almost all of the $20,000 that we were looking for. And it would seem that that would be fair, given that those three towns also participate at Frontier Regional and would help to support the benefit of having a school resource officer
If we did the numbers so that we did the EQE that we're doing with Frontier and all that other stuff, said, okay, we're kicking in $16,000, and if you take the numbers from the Frontier population,
sure,
and say that's $16,000 equates to this for the town of Whately and this for the town of Sunderland and this for the town.
Oh, right. And yeah. And I tried to just do number. That in my head.
Yeah,
so,
well,
that's what I mean.
As long as you do it by that formula, then it shows the towns are willing to kick in their portion to support Frontier's endeavor in that.
Sure.
But understand, Deerfield Elementary also has a benefit to it also.
I understand.
So unless we're going to offer it to the other elementary schools, you got to make sure that we pay our fair share for that also. So you got to take a little bit of money out. And
I just thought I would just make the ask.
No, I think it's great.
If we only get $3,000 from each town, that's still $8,000 or $9,000 more than we had.
Right. I don't mind the asking, but I don't want to get us into a position where we're promising.
Proportionately.
I don't want to get into putting the chief in a bad position that he's going to be asked to provide that services in each one of the elementary schools and not have him buy in before we actually ask the questions.
I don't think Brian can be stretched to the other elementary schools, basically.
I know,
but I just want to make it clear that we are not asking for the other elementary schools.
I'm asking to see if there's money at Sunderland, Whately, and Conway to see if there's any extra money to help fund the position.
Doug, you know that I feel very strongly about this. You know, we've already seen internet bullying kind of thing. They've already done that program in the elementary school, and from what everyone has said is really it was effective. It, you know, helped with the situation. There's so much potential for violence that you are paying for a presence. And if the kids feel comfortable with the presence of the officer there, you know, how do you put a dollar value on some violence that is prevented, you know? I mean, so I feel like it's very strongly about
that,
this.
That comfort level,
right?
All it would take would be one student
to mention
to
something.
To feel comfortable enough to come up to a police officer and say, I heard this kid say this thing. Maybe it's something you might want to look at. And suddenly you're preventing something horrible from showing up in the newspaper headlines, in every newspaper throughout the country in the next day. And I'm with the chief on this. I think that the position is absolutely essential.
I do too.
And even just this week, he confided in me on a couple of different incidents where a police presence definitely made a difference.
I know it is. I know we can't talk about this kind of stuff, but it does have impact.
Absolutely. So that's why I want to just get a clear sense from you as to where we're going with this position. If you feel strongly that it should stay in the budget and we're still looking for ways to fund it, then...
I think we should keep it in the budget, but I think we need to go back to the schools and say, you know, okay, we acknowledge that you've done some, but so isn't the taxpayers and so isn't everybody else.
Okay.
If you can't come up with the money, can you please find some other partnerships which will... Can they go to Pelican? Our people are stretched tight with everything we do. If we keep taking on the stuff that the school should be doing or somebody else should be doing, we're not helping our people appreciate what their values are. I think we really need to send the message to them. It doesn't mean we're not going to fund it, because I think that...
We're going to fund it somehow.
I think we're going to have to do something, but the aspect of it is I feel really...
Okay.
I think it's necessary for us to continue to ask for them to carry their share of this thought process.
Some.
I think that was the last direction that we had as a committee last meeting, was to research Eagle Brook Bement, because there was still some talk there, to talk with them about funding some of that, and then to feel and then to get, you know, we were asked last minute, you know, about this, and you know, our budget's set, we're like $20,000 where, and then just to get some more discussion with the officer and what are the tangible things if we're going to be creating this position for a long term and funding another department's position, albeit this is where they're coming to our school and to the other schools, and I think it's very valuable too, long term, and how we'd just like to see ways that, and talk about things that, what they will do, tangible items of how that time's going to be spent, so we know what we're funding, if we're going to fund this long term forever, you know, because it's going to be a long term.
It's a very reasonable request to understand what it is, the value added, and we assume, and we don't know that for a fact, that basically there's a good dialogue between our chief, the resource officer, and the management of the elementary school.
Oh yeah, very.
And high school, and that tangible thought process should be easily
documented.
Yes.
With the four heads or five heads coming together and saying this is what we've seen.
Right.
And these are the areas we think we need to move into, because I honestly believe that at some point in time this resource officer is going to need resources. Mm-hmm. There's going to be things that resource officer is not going to be able to provide.
Right.
He's going to recommend that we do programs, we do something that keeps our kids safe and keeps, you know, things on track. And we're going to have to pony up the money to do that, because it's not going to be cheap, and it's not going to be, well, some of it's free, but it's not going to be cheap if it's cost money.
Right.
So that dialogue is essential, but it's not going to go anywhere if we can't come to an agreement of
getting it off the ground.
What is the value?
Right.
And the message I'm getting right now is that it's nice, but...
Right.
But it's nice.
It's not Holyoke, so...
So, yeah, and again...
I think it's valuable because it's...
I think it's hugely... Just the number of overdoses that have occurred even in the town of Deerfield...
It's not getting any easier around
...is telling you that it's already at our homes. And that next step is, if it hasn't come to the schools first, that's the next step, because that influences what you see at home, influences what they take to school. So,
Before you adjourn, I do need about a 3.5-minute executive session for the reasons stated in your agenda.
Okay, the Board of Selectmen may enter into the executive session.
Wait a minute.
As allowed by MGL Chapter 30A, Section 21A6, to consider the purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property if the chair declares an open meeting may be detrimental effect to the negotiating position of public body. So is that the reason, Doug?
That is the reason.
Okay.
For purchase and exchange of real estate.
Okay.
Yep.
I vote aye.
Are we going to readjourn after the meeting, or is this the closing of the meeting?
The signing of the warrant?
We already signed it.
It's already signed.
So we're going to go home.
So this will conclude the meeting.
Yes.
We will adjourn out of executive session. I vote aye.